Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show. I'm Dwayne.
And I'm David.
And we're just two best friends talking about the show we love, Survivor. Tonight, we have a very special guest. He is the winner of Survivor Worlds Apart. His name is Mike Holloway. Everybody Mike, how are you doing?
Where's that guy?
I'm doing good.
How are you guys?
Doing great. Here's your theme music. Gentlemen, Mike Holloway!
So, I'm like following this stuff on Twitter, by the way, people, and it's a lot to keep up, so put the STWDD
tag
so we can get the questions in.
Yep, I will do my best. Oh my gosh, they're all over the place.
Hey, Dave.
Yeah, hey, Mike.
Dude, good headwear tonight, brother.
It's like I'm looking in a mirror.
I mean, are angels singing?
I thought that was only with Kelly, but I hear them right now.
I mean, Kelly's on next season. Let me just do a shameless plug. Kelly's on next season. I could come on and you know, talk about Kelly's game.
Hey. Oh, that would be incredible. More angels.
You can be a frequent guest.
I mean, I'd love that. I love you guys.
All right, people. I am going to try to get all of your questions in as the show goes on. Right now, we're going to get a couple of housekeeping things out of the way. We are live on our website and on YouTube. People are in the chat room chatting. If you want to know how to get there, stwdd.com/live. And on Twitter, hashtag stwdd, and your comment may make it on the air. I do want to give a shout-out to our newest D&D patron. She joined up today. Her name is Jackie.
And, Jackie!
Yes. In fact, we're having a D&D patron cast or patron-only podcast in a couple of weeks with all of our patrons. So if you want to find out more about supporting both of our podcasts, Survivor Talk with D&D and Movie Talk with D&D, click the green Patreon button on the right side of our website, which is stwdd.com. Of course, thank you for all of you who shop Amazon using our links. And David and Mike, this Friday night, my wife and David's wife.
I was about to say Terry. Terry Dietz's wife is coming on Survivor Talk.
David's wife and my wife are joining us for a special double date edition of Movie Talk with D&D. We are going to record
Thursday night.
I thought we were recording Thursday night.
Have you already announced what you're reviewing?
The movie is going to be Summersby. Remember, our wives picked it.
Summersby. Well, hey, that's much better than the movie I watched last night.
Which was?
Sleepless in Seattle.
Dude!
Absolute worst movie.
Really?
Oh, my gosh.
Tom Hanks, why? Actually, I'm Dwayne. I'm kidding. I'm a chick flick. Dude, bro, I love Sleepless in Seattle.
Oh, yeah, you listened to our show, so you knew I love that movie. You were just with me.
Had to rip you a little bit on it, man. No, I love Sleepless. I'm a big softy, a big romantic at heart.
Yeah. Well, I don't want to give away my thought. Now, we won't be live on whenever we do it, but you can be looking for it on the iTunes and, of course, on our website. But I will not give away my thoughts, but I was surprised. I watched it this afternoon.
What?
I watched Summersby with my wife this afternoon, and I came away with different feelings than I went in.
Well, I have a confession.
What?
Your wife did not recommend this as much as I did. This really was stemmed from my recommendations. You're blaming your wife. Don't blame your wife.
In case Are you really a girly man?
I'm having some mixed emotions about this conversation. I'm feeling like I'm back in the bromance on the island with Rodney and Joaquin, you know. Yes.
There you go. Nice shirt you have on there, Mike. Is that yours?
Well, I mean, no, it's actually not mine. See this or not. It's like a Baby Gap, but I believe we have a patron that is going to get all these signatures that is on this shirt.
Yeah, go ahead and stand up again. I have you on the screen now. So that is a women's medium.
He's still in survivor shape. He was man.
I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go.
Yeah, Shayna Davis won that shirt. It was a patron contest, and she won. And did everybody sign it from the current season?
All 18. I told you I'd get it done, and I got it done, sir.
Wow. Yeah, you and Max. So thank you very much. Appreciate it a lot. Shayna, you will be getting your shirt soon.
By the way,
she'll probably never wear it out.
By the way, it wasn't just Max. Like, there was a bunch of people in on this, you know, taking care of this shirt. You had Shireen, you had Max, you had the New England Boston crew up there. So, I mean, hey.
Yeah.
This is a Dirty 30 project.
Dirty 30 project. There you go.
Well, that was very awesome and kind of the Dirty 30 to do that for our patron winner, Shayna. So, way to go. So. All right. Well, let's see. Anything else? Oh, if you're watching Big Brother, use our CBS All Access, and you can get live feed starts in less than a month, David. Big Brother.
I love Big Brother. David, I would never play it, but I love it. David,
these people are not a fan. I saw the wrong season to start watching that show.
Yes,
Which season?
You saw two seasons ago.
Was it Aaron and Spencer?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh, that one. Oh, I love Spencer.
Yeah. All right, so let's go ahead and get some of these YouTube before it just, like, totally gets out of hand. This is from Ashley Hicks. Mike, would you ever play Survivor again if given the chance?
Absolutely not. Never. Never again. One and done.
All right.
I've said it before. I'll say it again. I'm not going to back down from it. I'm going to be the first one to ever win this game three times. And, I mean, I people can take that as a challenge or whatever, but...
Three times?
Three times, brother. Three times.
Hey, if you're giving
ropes to let you back on,
I don't know, man. Maybe give him half of the winnings or something.
Hey, if they call you right now and say all winners, all stars, or Philippine style, three returnees and new players, which one would you choose to go on?
I'm gonna set that up with a two-part answer. I would like to play against, you know, really, really stiff competition, but I want to get my second win so then I can challenge Sandra for the dominance of 1v1, you know, and then let's battle it out, me and Sandra, for number three, see who can take it down. But yeah. It'll probably be like seven more years, I think, before like an all-winner season could really happen numbers-wise.
Right.
You know, you have girls, some of the ladies, you know, that have played multiple times don't want to play again. You have, some of the girls, the ladies that have had babies, you know, are in different areas of their life and stuff. You know, some of the guys, there's a lot of guys, I mean, who knows? I don't even know if I could pass the psych exam again.
Right. Oh, Linda Fowler says, I'm women's medium. I'd love the shirt. Well, sorry, Linda.
Sorry, Linda.
Sorry, Linda. Wow, there are so many things on Twitter. I'll have to go back to it in a little bit. So I have five questions.
Are these the initial thoughts?
No.
We're not doing initial thoughts?
Hey, Mike went through 39 days to get on this show. You should give him the chance to do initial thoughts.
All right,
I thought the format of the show is we did initial thoughts at the top. I wrote down.
Right. Initial thoughts on your season. Since you're holding us to... You know what? You're just going to get mad and throw a tantrum if we don't do this exactly the way we're supposed to do it, aren't you?
It's not my birthday.
Just like you did at the camp, you're going to get mad at everybody because we're not getting the wood right.
If you don't go get wood, you get bloated.
Let me get my wooden pencil and throw it on the ground.
Initial thoughts, I really enjoyed the season. It was great.
Dude, that's a great initial thought. I love it.
So I guess you came prepared with one since you're giving us a hard time.
My first initial thought is I love the season as well, but not the season of... Wait, are you looking...
You have stuff written down. He really did have initial thoughts, David.
That's better than me sometimes.
I love the season, not our season, but watching you guys. You know, I've been in different rooms whenever I've been watching you guys, and some people have been like, oh man, you know, they need to get into more of the gameplay. You know, they go off in these rabbit trails. Well, I'm a rabbit trail hunter, so I love it. I love the concept of your show that you guys, two friends talking about Survivor. How great is that? Great concept. I love it. Second initial thought. The Destroyers got throttled this season, bro.
Oh, man.
Team Cholera. What's up?
I got destroyed. You know, it was David, didn't you get like double the points in our D&D?
I was like 32 points from doubling you up. I was going to send Shayna cookies if she'd find those 32 points.
Gosh. So. All right. David, do you have any initial thoughts so that Mike doesn't get mad at us? No, you don't. Come on.
My initial thought on this season, since Dwayne already said he loved the season, and I did too, was CBS or Approached or whomever missed a great opportunity to extend the ratings one more week by having a second chance episode to celebrate 30 years and do the whole second chance reveal. Instead of cramming it into a short reunion, I really wish they'd done it the next week. Enjoy this week, celebrate it, and introduce the people. And I mean, there's no way to block people talking and getting together, but everybody knew whoever all the ballot was.
Yeah.
Let them keep voting another week and then reveal a week later.
You know,
they could have done a video celebration of 30 years of Survivor, the best moments. See, Dwayne
and highlights.
Yes, highlights.
You know, like when they're showing a person, and here's Kelly Wentworth's highlights.
Yeah.
Which wouldn't hate be it. A whole lot because they didn't show hate her a lot. But.
Being a huge fan of the show, going back to the seasons where, like, in the middle of the season, we got that pump-up episode where it's like, oh, this is what happened. Dude, right whenever that came on, it was like, previously on Survivor. This week we're going to go over. I'd turn it off.
No, I hated the midweek episode. Yes, hated the mid-season episode. Don't like that at all. But they could have done this after the finale. I'm talking about the next week after the finale.
Yeah.
Have the finale, and then the next week have the reveal for Second Chance.
But you have you also have to think about from their perspective. They have 10 million, 11 million viewers right there at that point, at that time slot. You know, I mean, we could go on for an hour talking about, you know, different things in the game or whatever. They've got to pump up the next season. I mean, they did it to 29. Yeah. They did it, you know, they've done it, you know, congruently throughout the past, you know, three or four seasons. That's all good, man. We knew as a Dirty 30, as a group, as a whole, that we had a limited time to have as much fun as we possibly could. Right. And that's exactly what we did. We took this, you know, I mean, we've been called all kinds of names on Twitter and whatever. We don't care. Like, we just had fun. And this right. like this right here with you guys, this is fun. You know, I wish every single one of our cast members could come on and say, what's up?
Is that a CBS employee badge back there?
Yeah. Oh, look, there's a Probst cutout in the background. Hey, what's that? We need to get back on CBS's tow line? Okay.
There we go. Hey, you know what?
All right, here's a Twitter question that I have the answer for.
Oh, yes.
What are you going to spend your winnings on? Well, I have a brand new Maserati out there that he bought for me. David's got a new Mustang convertible that he bought for him. So what are you going to do with the rest of it?
Oh, man. It's funny. This is really a question that's been asked a lot. But
Oh, yeah, I know it has, which is why we didn't ask it.
No. It's all good. First minimum 10% is going to go to God, going to go to tithing.
Right.
One of my best friends is starting a new church. And so, you know, it's going to be going to a lot of that. Mm-hmm. Then I bought, okay, I'll break down and tell everybody. I wasn't going to tell everybody, but, my big purchase, I made a big purchase today.
All right.
And that purchase cost me, $5,600.
Holy smokes, a whole 0.8%.
Dude, that's a lot of money.
I know.
That's
half my son's tuition for the semester. Go ahead. It's a lot of money.
It's so bad. Okay. So I bought my final immunity puzzle from Survivor.
Oh, awesome.
The money goes to, you know, cancer.
Right.
But there's some selfishness in there, I'm not going to lie. Cass, you guys told me that Cass bought hers, actually.
Yeah, it's her garage.
The final five puzzle that her husband got to watch her do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
she bought it and put it in her garage. Yeah.
Actually, it was final four. It's the one that knocked out Spencer. There you go.
Yeah. Well, good for you, man. I'm glad you bought that. And if you think $5,000 is a high price item, then you're going to have your money for a long time.
Hey, are you You gonna send it to Rodney so he can practice with it?
Oh, Rodney! I don't know. He might not. He might not be able to get it for a while. That was a tough puzzle.
Oh man! All right, I do have questions that no one else has asked you
yet.
Let's
do it. I'm ready.
Here we are. How bad does the underwear actually get on the island?
Pretty bad. I was fortunate. We were fortunate enough to have a fresh body of water. Not just the ocean. So, you know, if you go and take your underwear in the ocean and they dry, they're all salty and stiff and ugh. But Dan's underwear were extremely easy to clean because he didn't have any. But, no, kidding. We had a fresh body of water, so, you know, we'd go in there and wash and exfoliate. And I mean, I don't know, there's something about being on an island and eating rice and beans that your skin and everything, it's whatever. After a day or two, you get used to it.
Well, thank you for wearing the longer underwear, because Philip taught us all a valuable lesson.
My thighs are so skinny that you would not want to see that.
Now, my second question I've already alluded to, are you going to yell and get out and get onto us if we don't work hard enough during the podcast? And you've already done that, so...
I mean, maybe. I don't know. That's a funny thing. That was really and truly my trigger. Lindsay's trigger was the food, and she would, ration the food in a certain way, and man, me and Rodney were dying. And Rodney would tell her just straight to her face. He would be like, why are you rationing the food? You're not even going to be here 39 days. It's just like, oh, my gosh. But, yeah, that was my stress reliever. I would just go work. I mean, I don't know.
Well, why did they show you? I mean, did you really get upset with everybody for not working?
Okay, so the very first time that they show me getting upset is, I think it's the second episode. Everybody's been laying around. We have no water whatsoever. Zero water's been boiled. We haven't even gone and gotten any. And so we get up, and I'm like, y'all, we're leaving for a challenge seriously in like an hour. And it takes a full hour to get a pot of water, boil, you know, get enough fire around it, boil it. And then, you know, you got to wait an hour to cool it down. So we actually go to that challenge with steaming hot water in our canteens because, and I'm just like, guys, we're not just playing a game. We're also surviving. And there are things that have to be done around camp.
Right.
And I'm not saying I was the only one working because I wasn't. But there was a lot of things not getting done that had to be done, and that was just one small case about it. So, yeah, there were a couple times, man, where, I mean, you're in a situation where you're hungry, you're not tired, and everybody gives this excuse. But, you know, the real you comes out, and I didn't know how to deal with those emotions at that point in time in the game until Kelly graciously, and we'll get into that in a minute, but, you know, pulled me aside and...
You know, like, pop me back into place and was like, yo, settle down.
Well, tell us about that. Go ahead and tell us about that.
So, me and Kelly, I don't know how many people know this or not, but Kelly and I were, like, close day one. Day one, we saw each other, you know, driving in on the thing, and, you know, we made eye contact. But day two, we actually formed, you know, our alliance. And, hold on one second. The cool thing about Kelly and I were... is that we would wake up in the mornings because we'd be the first two up, always. And either we would go down to the river and do dishes, or we'd go get some firewood or whatever, but we would take that 30 minutes and have, like, our strategy conversation. Well, then we wouldn't talk pretty much the rest of the day. She would go be with the girls, I would be with the guys, or we would switch, you know, kind of places and just gather information for each other. And then we'd meet up at the end of the day and we'd talk. And, you know, she was a great source of, you know, strategy talks, great source of just calming me down. You know, we're so much alike in so many different ways. It's hilarious. But one thing instrumental in my game was around day 12 or day 11, day 10, something like that, I went off. I mean, I was pissed, not happy. And just went off about the working. It was during the Lindsay fight and all that.
Right.
And she pulled me aside and was like, Mike, you gotta calm down. And kind of had like a come to Jesus meeting with me, like for real. Like, yo, you have to make the merge. I'm gonna make the merge. From there, we'll go all the way to the end. And it really refocused me. And I was like, oh man, uh-huh. I'm alienating people through this work thing. And I calmed down for a little bit, but then towards the end, I was just like, whatever, I don't care.
Well, but it probably helped that you went, whatever, I don't care. Right?
Well, yeah. I mean, well, after the target was on me, like completely on me, I could yell at anybody. It didn't matter at that point. You know, like, because they were still going to get rid of me. So.
Yeah.
Hey, let's go back before we get too many more questions in the season. I want to go back to when you first saw the 18. When you, even, I guess, before you got on the trucks, if there was a place where you got to see the 17 other people.
Yeah,
let's remember talk back about to that. Who jumped out at you? Since you're a fan since day one, like we are, who jumped out? Because I go into the DMV and I make my alliances without talking to people. And I pick out the first boots. Who's got to go? And my daughter and I did this on the beach the other day just for fun. And my daughter goes, temper. Short temper over there. We can use him or we can get rid of him. And I couldn't believe she was doing it after I told her what I was doing. It was the funnest thing to do on the beach. Yeah. But who jumped out?
It sounds like a fun game. Actually.
It is. You start making up stories about people. And Bailey started making up stories about this guy. He yells at his kids. You know, he does this. And then there's this other dad who's jogging with his, like, 10-year-old son. She goes, that's a guy you want to align with. He's spending time with his kid. He looks clean cut. He looks educated. He doesn't look arrogant. He looks like he loves. He's watching his son jog. It's awesome. He's getting into it with his kid, you know. So I'm like, okay, I'm aligning with him. Is that okay with you? So, but we're just chilling on the beach. But who, when you finally saw the 17, who jumped out at you? And did you know at that time that you were going to be blue, red, and gold, yellow? Or were you just looking at the whole group saying, okay, that's a threat. And, ooh, I want to align with them. What was your first impression before you saw blue collar, no collar, white collar?
Okay, so let's do a little bit of behind the scenes stuff. You know, because I haven't told very many awesome. People this, but I don't know. Okay, so we left Miami, we get to Nicaragua, and we are carted in these vans, blacked out. Everything's blacked out, always blacked out. You can't ever see anywhere where you're going. We get, you know, to Ponderosa, the pregame place. We get there, and like, you know, it's like you're camping out. You're sleeping in tents. You know, there's one. There's like two or three showers that are going on. Cold water. You don't have hot water. And then all day long you're sitting in a gazebo, surrounded by these other 17 players that you can't speak to or even look at.
Right.
With threat of. If you look at these people eye to eye, or if you talk to them or communicate with them in any way, we're sending you on a plane home. We've got alternates waiting to come take your spot. So it's like, happened. Oh, my gosh,
that what's has going on? Yes.
Yeah. So, we're not going to get into that.
I'm not saying who. I'm just saying that.
Exactly. So, basically, you get there, and just like you said, you start sizing people up. I had a journal, which I still have today. To answer your question in short form, Joe, Tyler were the two guys that I were that pregame. I called Tyler Superman or Clark Kent, and I called Joe the artist because I didn't know his name, but he was always drawing, which told me, and this is very interesting. I wrote this in my journal that he sees the whole picture. You know, like he looks at things and sees the larger scheme of things, and so that's what I was like, man, this guy's possibly dangerous, and he's going to be really good at puzzles.
So you were giving them stories as well. To call somebody Superman Clark Kent, you see that he can be mild-mannered with his glasses. He takes them off, and he's a giant. You know, he's going to come at you physically. So see, you're already doing the same thing.
I mean, Joaquin was Backstreet Boy, but more because of how he dressed. And because, hey, that dude's slick, man. Don't take nothing away from Walk. That guy, man, he's got a silver tongue. I'll tell you what, he's a good kid.
Were you surprised at Joe's lack of, apparently, his lack of strategic game?
Yes, I was, honestly. I love Joe. Take nothing away from Joe, and I hope that he learned a lot of really good lessons on Worlds Apart. But yeah, he. I think the biggest thing with Joe was he got comfortable in the place that he was, and I don't think that he'll make that same mistake. I think that he'll strategize. I think that he'll scramble. You know, one question that got asked to me the other day by a friend was, He goes, you know, what do you think the big one of the biggest parts of your game was? And I just told him, I said, dude, I scrambled every single day, whether I was safe or not, didn't matter. I didn't care about being seen as playing the game because I came into the assumption and telling everybody, we're all players. We're all going to play the game. So that's like a backhanded compliment that allows me to make moves without being, oh, well, he already said he's going to play the game. So,
right.
You know, it's such a tricky game. I mean, it really is. To go back to your point as well of who I thought I would have worked with,
yeah,
so crazy. Kelly, like, seriously, that girl glows. When you meet her in real life, mm-hmm. I mean, this is I joke with her all the time about it. She walks around and she like glows. I don't know what she rubs on her body as far as lotion is concerned, but she literally glows. And it was just when we finally connected, it was like my heart and my head agreed on her, you know. And it was an instantaneous thing. It wasn't like a prolonged relationship that we developed. It was 100% instant connection.
One of those people you feel comfortable with right away.
Right away.
Yeah.
Right away. Huge part.
Gotcha.
Hey, so day one, by the way, we actually did get a shelter. This is something funny I wanted to share with you guys. We did actually get like the bottom part of the shelter done, and we had it all laid out, and we went to bed that night. And you know what? Dan is right. He is a fat guy. The bamboo will not hold him. It is hollow.
That was a funny.
The shelter broke in the middle of the night.
Really?
It's like, tsh! And so like Dan's on this side, and poor Kelly's over here, and they roll into each other.
Oh no! Oh, poor Kelly.
And we're all up at the top or whatever, and poor Kelly's laying on this like crack in the middle, and I'm like, Kelly, come switch places with me. So the first night, I get to lovingly cuddle in the bottom of the cuddle puddle with Dan Foley in a broken shelter.
Wow.
Hey, now, we had a question come in. Do cameras run 24/7? Do they ever shut off? They do run
24/7.
So we had a chance to see Dan be right about something, and we still didn't get to see it.
Oh, man, yeah. He was, you know, the funny thing about it was Dan was right about a lot and wrong about a lot this season.
Yeah. I just love to see him underneath the pile saying, I told you! I told you!
I told you I was fat!
No, get off me!
No, Dan is literally a sleeping inferno. You know what I mean? Like, he, at night when he sleeps, he changes the air around him by 2 degrees minimum.
Really?
Seriously.
He's that hot.
Is that hot?
See, when my wife finally goes to bed, her feet drop in temperature about 20 degrees.
Oh, I know.
And she's got the iceberg feet that try to find my feet.
Hey, Max Dawson tweeted at us. Did you guys see that?
Yeah, why don't you say what it is and go ahead and answer it. It's a good question.
It says, please ask Mike about the meaning of the #Dirty30 and why we thought it was important to celebrate Survivor. And that's at FY Maxwell. The Dirty 30. Well, you know, when we came back from Nicaragua,
everyone was pretty much talking, and we really felt like that we had accomplished and did something special. And we knew that we wanted this family, what's the word, family microcosm, I guess, to stay together and to be, you know, in each other's lives. And because this is such a tough experience. I mean, for any of you guys out there that are watching this that want to go on Survivor, this is such a tough experience. And I can't imagine not having each one of these family members that I now have to go through with this. So really, the Dirty 30 is family. That's what it means to all of us. I mean, yeah, we have our squabbles. Yeah, we have, you know, unresolved issues. But we're a family, and we take up for each other, and we love each other, and it's a community. You know, what I will relate it back to, and I never shy away from this. This is something that I've always said and will always say. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And in this life, my life, I want to love people. I want them to know that there's something different about me because I have Christ that lives in me. And he loved me whenever I was unlovable. And not that any of these people are unlovable, but we're all people. We're just regular people that got an amazing opportunity that love this game, and yet, man, I love these people so much. I mean, they're such a huge part of my life now, and that's what Dirty 30, that's what it means to me. Yeah, we went out there and we played a dirty, dirty game, but we did it with smiles on our faces, and we came back with love in our hearts. So,
So just for Max, I'll put my white collar back.
Hey, wait. What? Are Angel singing? What's going on here, man? What's happening?
Now, let me ask.
I have a Blackhawks flag.
All right, well, there you go. So,
Chicago, okay, Blackhawks.
Chicago, actually.
That's my next question. Game one starting soon. Blackhawks or Lightning? Who's winning?
Blackhawks, 100%.
Oh, come on. Like, it's even going to be a competition.
It's not. It's going to go 5 games, 4-1. 4-1, Blacks.
Yeah, but it's going to be fun to watch.
Yeah.
How about that goal? Oh, my gosh. From behind the line.
Dude, you love hockey? I love
hockey. I love hockey.
Love hockey so much. All
right. I like hockey, but I don't get to watch the playoffs, which we love. Right now, we're watching college softball because my daughter is a trainer with the college softball team. But anyway.
Oh, that's cool.
Anyway, how exciting for you, Dan.
There was a 10-game inning the other night, last night, wasn't there?
Dwayne, I know your sports is limited. Yeah, UCLA and Auburn. So
a 10-game inning. Wow.
10-inning game.
Dwayne, anyway.
Hey, y'all want to see something cool?
What's that?
Dude, this is parchment.
That looks like tree mail.
This is not tree mail. This is actually hidden community idol parchment that I found in the tree.
Hey, I got one of those too.
Do you?
No, I'm just kidding.
So this is what it comes in. It comes in this like little parchment like this.
Yeah.
And then you open it up. Obviously, the idol's in there. I don't have the idol. That went for way more money than I wanted to spend.
Right. Well, you know, if you'd kept it.
yeah, I could add it. But then they give you, I don't want to do it too long because I don't want to get in trouble, but
okay.
Then they give you this.
All the rules?
Uh-huh. Like, yeah. It's
that's a lot of rules.
And then it has a blue, I don't know, can you see the blue?
Yes.
Yeah, it has a blue idol thing. So yeah, uh-huh. Dude, there's.
That's official parchment. You can't fake that.
You can't. This is the real deal, legit Holyfield, baby.
Sweet. That is awesome.
Anyway, I just wanted to share that with you guys.
You do. Since you just found that, you should do the happy dance for us.
The happy? You know what we do when we get the... Hey, that's a shout-out to my boy John Pike, man. He's actually the one that came up with that, like 17 years ago. And it's just something like, we'll be playing a game of ping pong, seriously. He'll slam it on me and happy dance.
Oh, man, he must have loved seeing you do that on the show then.
Oh, yeah. That was a shout-out to the people in my life that know me the best.
Wow.
Hey, before we got on hockey, you brought up your faith, and I wanted to ask you, were there times in the game where you got to be alone or got to just draw back on that? And I'm not saying that's an advantage to you, but as a person who also has faith, I find it to be a huge advantage in certain situations where you can step back and say, you know what, in the greater scheme of things, this conversation is not that important. This argument is not that important. This battle is not that important. Get on with it. Move on with it. Step aside and let things happen, and then go about and continue the way you're going.
Yeah, I'll tell you like this. Every morning I would get up. In the later parts of the game, I would just go to where the ladies' couch was because it really was very comfortable. It was that big. The ladies' couch was this big log, and it had these sweet cutouts that it had just washed up from somewhere, and it was perfect to lay on. So at the later parts of the game, that's where I would go. And in the morning, I would go and first thing, get up and go sing praise and worship. And pray and everything. I was actually on a phone call today with Max, and we were talking about it. And I said, Max, I go, I don't believe that God really cares who wins Survivor or any reality TV show for that matters. But I know that God cares about me, and I know that I spent time with Him in the morning times, and you know, and strengthening myself. And in Psalms it talks about David going and encouraging himself in the Lord.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And whenever I didn't have anybody else, you know, to rely upon, like physically in the game, you know, I always had God there, and I always felt at peace. You know, when we would be going to the challenges, man, I would just, you know, go into, if you want to call it the humanistic point of view or whatever, you know, like a meditation mode, if you would. Like, I would flip a switch in these challenges. And the only thing that I can accredit to is that it was like God in me flipping the switch and just focus. Just, mm-hmm. I mean, just the really funny, the day that I won the ball challenge where you had to hold the, with the tongs.
Yeah.
That morning in my prayer time, I specifically prayed for balance and speed that day. I don't know why. Have no idea why I prayed for that, but that's what I prayed for. Come to find out, that was the key ingredient in what I needed that day, right. You know. And I mean, it's just little things like that, you know. People subscribe to faith. You know, I'm not here to sit here and preach Jesus, you know, down anybody's throat. What I'm here to do is show you the love of Christ and show you that, you know, hey, I'm not a perfect person. I mess up every single day, right. But that God, you know, loved me, and I'm willing to love you if that's, you know, in the cards. If we make a relationship, anybody that I come across, man, I try to show the love of Christ. I don't always succeed, but do my best.
I appreciated that they allowed that in the edit. They allowed you to say the things that you did and allow that to be part of your testimony, you know, part of your survivor life. So I was really appreciative that they did that. Yeah,
I was too, actually. It was really, really the class act, in my opinion.
We actually had a post on our Facebook group that I thought was really good, and it has like 12.
Did you write it?
No.
Okay. I thought that's what you thought.
It has like 12 comments after it, and it shows the impact that you had as a Christian on Survivor.
Okay.
This person wrote, and I don't want to call him out, so I'm just going to say, as an atheist, I often cringe at the religious fervor that sometimes appears in Survivor. The level of hypocrisy and arrogance, as seen with the likes of, and then they mentioned a few people, and others, can send a chill down the spine. All caps. But I think Mike showed how his belief can be used as a personal strength. And the way he acknowledged his feelings at the finale was totally different. Good on him, a worthy winner. And what I wrote back to this person, I agree. I hate the hypocrisy that I see out there. And I loved how you represented Christ with love in a very good way. And you even had an impact on someone who is an atheist. So, you know. Way to go, man. I'm just
I'll tell you like this. It's you sometimes in life you're put in positions to be tested. And I'm not saying that it was a test, but I know, just like the scripture that's on my back, Psalm 121. I know where my strength comes from. Mm-hmm. And that's from the Lord, you know. It's real to me. And that's all that matters. It doesn't have to be real to anybody else in this world, but it's real to me, and it's my relationship with who I believe is my creator. Right. And I don't know, man. It's so cool. It's so cool to live life free of drama, not drama, because there's always drama in your life, but knowing that someone paid the price for my sins, knowing that, you know, I have someone that loves me unconditionally all the time. Man, that's a huge strength, having that in your corner.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, speaking of the grace of God, my wife has a question for you.
Yeah, let's do it.
Were you born and raised in Texas, or were you brought there by the grace of God?
No, I am. Thank you for this. Thank you to your wife for asking this question. I'm a sixth generation Texan.
There you go.
That's
proud.
Dude, it's something that is so deeply entrenched in me. My great-great-great-grandfather had the very first cattle drive from Texas to Colorado.
Oh, wow.
The Loving Goodnight Trail. Loving County is named after our family. I'm the last male in my line that actually carries the Loving name. My full name is Michael Anthony Loving Holloway. Yeah, I mean, like, it goes deep. I mean, look at the Texas flag right here.
I know.
I have four Texas flags right in eyesight right now, in my living room.
And there's a bathing suit somewhere.
Yeah.
Colby's got nothing on you, man.
Oh, Colby. I love Colby Dunn.
So she wants to know, are you NFL or NCAA football?
Both.
Or high school?
Dallas Cowboy fan?
Cowboy fan, Texas fan, Texans fan.
All right. Yeah.
Yep.
Giga Maggies.
Giggle Maggies and Go Frogs. Go Frogs.
So that was my wife's. In fact, you know, this afternoon you and I talked for about 45 minutes trying to get all this Google Hangout stuff. And
thank
I
you,
said,
by the way. I'm an idiot.
Oh, that's okay. And no, you're not. And I said, Connie, I'm sorry this has taken so long. She said, he's from Texas. It's okay.
Maybe I do think slow. Dang it.
No. She was saying, it's okay. This is taking 45 minutes. He's from Texas. It doesn't matter what he does, Dwayne. It'll be all right.
But bless him. Okay. I got you.
Yes. All right, so we are 41 minutes past the go live mark, and we still haven't got you the first episode yet. So let me ask you, were there any and I know we're going to jump around, so I'm just going to throw some random to get Dwayne back on track. So were there any winks, waves, nods in the trucks on the way to the first site?
Besides you and Kelly?
Yeah. I mean, not really. You know, there was...
They were right there in your face with the camera, so I guess it was kind of hard.
Yeah, I mean, of course, we were gamers. I mean, there really were a bunch of gamers that came to play. And so, I mean, yeah, you get away with a little bit of stuff. I'm not going to sit here and say we were perfect angels, because if you're not playing the game during the casting process and keep playing it all the way through to the end, mm-hmm. then you're going to lose the game. I mean, the game starts the day that casting calls you the very first time and goes, are you interested in being on Survivor since you sent us a video? Yeah. And you're like, yes. That's when the game actually starts, people. So,
wow.
You know, get going. Go ahead.
Some would say the game is still on. In other words, I've heard some past survivors say that every survivor is still playing because they might go on again. And so they're, even when they talk to us, or even when as you talk to us, you're still thinking, I might go on again. So.
Yeah, he's thinking Dave's an alliance and Dwayne's an early boot. That's what he's thinking.
What do you guys think? You guys think I'll ever play this game again?
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, well, Propes liked you as a winner, for one. So, yeah, I think you'll either be on a winter season or an all-star season.
I'm surprised the refrigerator is not painted in the flag colors.
Well, yes. You know, I'm just getting a nice, tasty ice cream.
Oh, thanks a lot. That's what I needed to see.
Yeah.
I just told you how much I weighed or before we got on the air. Why I'm not drinking a Red Bull.
He's got to fill up his thighs. He's got to get his thighs.
Yeah. Dr. Pepper and Snickers.
Dr. Pepper and Snickers.
Hey, so how many videos did you ever send in? Did you only send in one and win, or did you send in a bunch?
One and done. I actually was sitting, I'll tell you guys the story, because I already said it on RHAP. I was sitting there watching Colton kind of quit for the second time, and it made me so mad. And one of my best friends was like, what are you going to do about it? Said, I'm going to make it. Dude, because I've been making Survivor videos for like 10 years, but I never sent one in.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, we're gonna piece them together. We're going to send it in. And, yeah, man, it was so crazy the day they called, because I was actually home. I was not on a rig, and I actually had cell phone service. They called me from a block number, which I never answer anyways.
Wow.
And I answered it, and it was Penny Lane Clifton. Hey, girl, what's up? And just immediately the switch flipped, you know, and you go into crazy mic mode, I guess.
Can you say if you were ever considered for other seasons, or was this the only season you were considered for?
Yeah, this was the only season that I was considered for.
Okay. Oh. This segment of the show sponsored by Frozen Snickers Bars.
Sorry. So good, though.
I know. We can tell by the look on your face.
All right, David. Go for it, man. Keep us going.
Oh, that's a good handoff.
Dude, I got something from the first episode.
I got Twitter stuff. Oh, go ahead, man.
So it's not exactly the first episode, but we'll go first. Eskimeca Blue Collar.
Yeah.
So, you know, we legitimately would fight like at least once a day. Somebody would have some type of blow up once a day. But we would also play 90% of the other days. Like the day that you saw us playing basketball and I was working. I got in there and played too. But, you know, there was something that needed to be done. There's days that you didn't see us. We're in the ocean. Lindsay, holy smokes, this girl. We had the smallest boogie board. You could see it in some of the edits. It was the thing that we would chop the fish heads on. But it was this small boogie board, and we were all out there, you know, trying to boogie board and get up on it, like much like you saw the no-callers do. Mm-hmm. Lindsay actually gets up on this the tiniest thing that my torso didn't even fit the whole boogie board. Uh-huh. She actually got up on a wave for like 2 seconds on this little bitty boogie board. And that day we're jumping off of each other's shoulders, you know, right. We're playing these games in the water. There was so much fun that we had that we were, you know, in the blue collar, we really were kind of a family. Uh-huh. And if you said something about somebody in my family, I'm coming at you. But I could say whatever I wanted to, and they could say whatever they wanted to me. You know, and so that was a lot of interesting stuff that happened in the blue collar camp that we played a ton. Dan, we would stay up all night long. Dan would have these whodunit games, or how did they get killed, or 1,000 questions or whatever, but you can only ask yes or no questions. We would play these games all night long. Yeah, I mean, it's so much fun. But that's my initial stuff. Go ahead.
This was something that I thought balanced you out, because you came off as very excited. I'll volunteer. I'll make the decision for the tribe. I'll go do it. I don't care. I just want to play. And then you get busy with working and pushing. But then when it comes down to it, you're blue strong, and you're blue family. I felt like the blue was a family by the end of the first episode. I just felt like you were like the big brother who was kind of bossy, but at the same time, you would knock down anybody that stood up to one of your family members. And I felt like that's kind of a background story that we didn't necessarily get right away, but I kind of felt like that's why nobody wanted to target you, except for Rodney, of course, because he saw your greatness. But anyway, but early on, even though you were might have been abrasive or pushy, that it just seemed like nobody wanted to target you because you were like the big brother.
Well, Lindsay, I mean, I really will give Lindsay a lot of credit in this aspect. When she made that prediction the first day, mm-hmm. and no one else made that prediction, nobody on the red, nobody on the yellow. Lindsay, when she made that statement, like, I mean, it legitimately, I was already thinking it in my head. I told everybody pregame. I told Jeff before the game started. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people did, but, like, I really believed I was going to win the whole way through. Mm-hmm. I mean, I told them in casting. I told Penny all the way through casting. I was like, I'm going to win this. And she's like, yeah, whatever. I'm like, no, seriously, like, I'm going to win this. This is insane. I would send my stuff in to CVS, my wardrobe, and on the box, the FedEx box, I would write winner. You know, like, I mean, like, dude, seriously, I mean, this is all, I mean.
Since you didn't know the edit, when that made the edit, her statement, did you get like an extra heartbeat going through your body?
Well, yeah, because, I mean, that was my first tip-off from CBS saying you won. Because when I left the game, I really, really felt like I had won. Mm-hmm. And then whenever there was a middle part where, you know, during the before the show started, that really, really questioned it a whole lot. Mm-hmm. And then whenever I saw that, you know, like them putting that on there was just the okay, I won. Okay.
That actually leads into a Twitter question from Dylan Power. When was the very first moment you knew you had a legitimate shot at winning this game?
A year and a half ago.
There you go. That's what I was thinking. I mean, you're writing winner on your box, you thought it from day one, if not before.
Before. It's really funny. I was out on the rig, and when we sent the video in, and I told my best friend, I made this statement to my best friend. I said, if I send this video in, they're going to watch it. If they watch it, they're going to call me. If they call me, they're going to bring me out to L.A. If I go to L.A., I'm getting on the show, and if I get on the show, I'm winning. And he was like, all right.
And from that day, the day that I sent that video in, I started going hardcore, 2 hours a day of Survivor stuff.
Rather that been physical, rather it was mental, rather it was talking strategy, rather it was doing puzzles, didn't matter. I spent 2 hours a day from that moment on. The guys at the rig, I would leave the rig, drive an hour to go work out 2 hours, drive an hour back. And I specifically remember different times whenever I'd be working out really, really hard, doing different things in different ways. I'm not going to give all my strategies away about how I worked out and got prepared for the game, but it would be 106, 107 degrees out in the middle of the desert in Texas, and I'd be dying, man, like dying. Right. And the only thought that would go in my head was, when you win, you're going to look back on this moment, mm-hmm. and you're going to be so happy that you put this time in. And I look back on those moments, seriously, and I'm like, that's where I won the game.
Yeah. Go ahead. Well, you know how I had just said that you're still playing even though the game's over?
Mm-hmm.
You just demonstrated that.
Of course.
Right. So there you go. I'm not going to tell you all of my amazing tricks of how I strategize. I appreciate that. Go ahead, David.
So I had two quick notes. But one, you talked about shooting hoops at the camp and everything. And to me, obviously, not losing at challenges probably made for a little bit better atmosphere. But had y'all lost the first challenge, who do you think would have been gone?
Dan, 100%. Dan. All
right. And 100%. Well, my other question was, when y'all were shooting hoops, they edited it to look like you guys were shooting in preparation for a challenge. Were y'all shooting at random, or was it because of a hint you got in tree mail?
We didn't even get tree mail.
I remember that was the same episode as that challenge where y'all ended up shooting.
It was the day before. That actually happened the day before we went to that shooting challenge, and we had no idea. Sierra and we had that little basket, and they were like, hey, let's shoot some hoops. And so we rigged it up over there in that little tree and started shooting some hoops. It was, once again, it was very, very, very playful. Like, our camp was extremely playful, with a lot of huge, huge personalities. I think our tribe legitimately had the biggest amount of personalities on it, minus Sierra.
Yeah.
And that's not a dig at Sierra. That actually is a very, very huge strength, because her playing the damsel in distress part,
mm-hmm.
with Joaquin and Tyler, and even whenever we got into the merge and bringing back information for us,
right?
Brilliant.
Was that real or was that acting?
No, I think there was a moment where she thought about actually flipping over and going.
Well, you have to, yeah. Give her credit for that, yeah.
Yeah, but no, she played a role so masterfully that she had those other guys just believe and she was going with them. You know, like the day Joaquin goes home, this is funny, I have this in my notes. Here's a little inside story. The day that Joaquin goes home, he actually pulls me aside and he's like, okay, Mike, this is what we're going to do. We're going to get Joe. Because he didn't know that we threw the challenge, which I want to get into that too, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, we do too.
He had no idea that we threw the challenge, and he comes to me and he's like, Mike, you are not my target.
why do you feel you have to tell me that?
Like, the little devil that's sitting on my shoulder right here is like, but you're mine.
Yeah.
You know? And I mean, it's just one of those things with Walk. Walk was so cool. Like, Walk really did have the three C's in the challenges.
Uh-huh.
If you watch that guy in every challenge that he was involved in, man, the guy breezed through. It was so easy for him.
Yeah, he never stood out as a hindrance. I really wouldn't have mind seeing him. I know the individual game that I was predicting. I wanted to see him play the individual part of it, which I think could be a chance for him to come back in the game at some point.
I agree.
Second chancer. I really physically thought he was much better in the challenges than I thought he was going to be.
Yep, I agree. All right, what else you got?
Well, go to that challenge thing.
Well, hold on, we're not there yet. Wait a minute.
Sorry, David.
Did you guys see my sweet little merge cup that I got? It's wooden.
Oh, nice.
We haven't been invited over to the house yet, so we have not seen all your little trinkets.
Oh, well, I'll just periodically through the podcast, I'll just pull something out and show you guys. My booty.
Yeah. There you go. Well, don't pull that out, but okay.
No, you've seen enough of that.
Yeah.
Hey, family friendly, there you go. All right, so Episode 1 and 2 were obviously not blue-collar vote-outs, so y'all were safe there. Episode 3 went from Episode 3 to the reunion. That's kind of the episode that was talked about at the reunion. So I wanted to ask you, since I'm pretty sure you were there, if the jokes that Dan claimed were being said, that your mama jokes and stuff, if that actually happened, obviously we didn't see it in the 85 to 90 seconds that were shown on TV at the reunion, but did it ever happen the morning, anytime around that time?
See, Dan and I have had a talk about this, and I think even Rodney and I have talked about this, but no, that conversation that he was referencing actually happened like a day before or something like that.
Mm-hmm. And it was, it really was, you know, we were talking, oh, ha, 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 you know, you say this to your boys, you say that to your boys, and blah, 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 blah. And so, I mean, I believe that Dan was, no, I don't believe it. I know that he was referencing that conversation.
Yeah.
It was just a classic Dan Foley moment. It was the wrong thing to say at the wrong time to the wrong person.
Right. And, absolutely.
You know, and like that statement, seriously, is something that not everyone in America, but a lot of people, especially, you know, people that, from what I understand, from up Maine, up Northeast, are a lot more brash in how they speak about things. If he was sitting in his basement with his five buddies, that comment would have never even been, it wouldn't have been, but it was on national TV. So, yeah, Dan's gotten a lot of flack for that, but here's the thing with Dan. I really don't believe that Dan has an ill heart towards anybody. You know, you either love Dan Foley or you hate him, and yeah. I don't hate him, so there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah. To be a 24-hour gap and to suddenly say a comment like that, you know, Dan feeling obviously comfortable enough to say it, and right. But Roddy obviously having an actual reaction to it, just totally set it off. And I think, I mean, that makes sense that it would have happened 24 hours sooner. You know,
once again, that conversation was completely squashed 5 seconds after it happened.
Yeah.
You know, that was not a lingering thing. And, you know, what Dan was referencing too, though, we really did get back from that bucket challenge that day. I think it was the bucket challenge. And we were wiped.
Like, yes, it was.
Wiped out.
Yeah.
And I mean, we've been eating half as much as the white collars and the no collars.
When they brought all of their rice and stuff over to our camp, I was pissed. I'm like, we have like half a jug, and you guys have like this much rice. Like, you know, hey, but
so looking back, those first three episodes, would you have done it differently? Would you have eaten more?
If he could get rid of Lindsay, he would have eaten more.
I'll answer that question privately with you guys.
Okay. Oh, that's so mean to everybody else.
I'm sorry, y'all.
It's a future question. I mean,
write that down, Nate. Write that down, David. So
I have some thoughts on strategy about that particular issue.
You can obviously share with us because we will never get on the show.
We would never tell anybody.
We're not getting on the show. So
yeah, but the Another episode 3 goes by without the blue collar elimination, which is awesome. Yes. Episode 4.
By the way, didn't you predict the blue collars to go extremely deep in the game?
I'm pretty positive I did. There was even a soundbite, I think, last episode where David had Mike and Kelly had Mike and the angel sang, and Dwayne's comment was, really? He is like he's like on my season.
Way 29. Down on my list.
I drafted him season 29. He's so far back on my list. I did. I liked the blue collar. I put myself on that tribe. I just didn't see any. I didn't feel like there was going to be any big divides or anything. I just saw six people I thought could mesh. So I don't know. I just had a good feeling about the blue collar tribe, and I still do. So anyway.
And then the episode came when Dan said, "That is so stupid." Uh-oh, I'm in trouble.
Yeah, the fat guy has spoken. So anyway. But then we get to episode 4.
Okay.
And it all breaks loose because Mike sits out a challenge. Was that your choice? Why did you sit out that reward challenge where Kelly got busted?
To prove a point, if I'm being real.
Yeah.
The girls had gotten on this.
See, I've talked to Dan about this, so I wanted to hear your side of it, too.
Yeah, the girls had gotten on this, like, I don't know. People got really mad about sitting out challenges. Which, you know, I would too.
Was it because it was reward? Had it been immunity, would you have played?
Oh, immunity. I'm not playing an immunity. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, it was more to say, okay, hey, look, here, go. Girls, ladies, if y'all are listening, don't be mad at me when I say this. But it was like, yo, go screw it up. Let's see what you got.
They did.
You know? Well,
unfortunately for Kelly. It did get messed up
for the day. Yeah, way to
Kelly,
go.
Kel. She got six. Hey, Kelly, if you're listening, because she's packing to go to a thing tonight, and I think she's listening. Love you, Kelly. Love you. Love you, Lens. Love you, C.
However, I showed you that night.
You what?
However, I showed you at that challenge.
You're That's blowing right. my spot up. You're blowing it up.
No, like, you know what? Dan should have been the caller. He was the loudest one of all of us.
No kidding.
Like, seriously, yeah. he really should have been the caller. It was
bad strategy. Yeah. It really was. But
how long was medical looking at her?
Oh gosh, we didn't go back to camp for a solid hour. I think they really really took care of her, made sure she was good to go.
I mean, how long was the challenge stop? Do you remember?
Oh yeah, a solid 20, roughly 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And then the classic probe saying, "Now if you have a concussion, we'll know because you'll fall over during the challenge."
Oh, you don't know how hard it was for me because, you know, at that point, Kelly and I were really close. Mm-hmm. Like, I wanted to run out there on that field and just, you know, like, I don't know. I'm not a father. I don't have kids, but I kind of have that, like, protector instinct in me.
Right.
I just wanted to run out there and hold her, but then that would have blown up our whole spot.
Yeah.
And, I mean, dude, it's agonizing to see somebody that you've gotten so close with, you know, hurting, and you can't do anything about it.
Right.
So did you and Kelly have the let's make sure we avoid each other and not be obvious relationship?
Yeah, I mean that would be we had a lot of fun, me and Kel, but we would interact in a group setting. Mm-hmm. You know, like we would interact in the morning when no one else was up.
Right.
You know, the cool thing about Kelly was we got fire on day one, obviously, and you know kept it going. The whole time. So, like, the first 6 days, I was up every single night, you know, periodically. I'd go lay down for, like, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, get up, go put more wood on the fire, go back to bed. And I started, you know, really dragging. And one night, I think it was around night six, Kelly, Mike, you sleep tonight. Don't get up. Don't get up one time. Sleep. I'll take care of the fire all night long. And, man, just that sentiment alone was huge for me. You know, just somebody caring enough saying, "Hey, I see what you're doing."
Yeah, recognize them.
Take a break. Let me do it. And that's a moment that's with Kelly that supersedes the game, that goes further than game. That's real life compassion.
And I don't mean to insult, but I never got the sense we would have heard that comment from no collar or white collar. It's just, to me, it's almost something like a blue-collar comment would say. You know, they see the load that you're carrying, they're willing to carry the same load, so they'll step up and do it for you, just to help you.
Well, you know what Joaquin says. We can't build a fire because we hire people to build fires.
We hire blue-collar to come over here.
Yeah.
I'll take your money to come build you a fire.
There you go.
All right, so the next immunity challenge ends with that ball in the hole thing that you really probably couldn't practice from home. I think it was that one.
You definitely couldn't practice that from home. No. Are you talking about this ball? This ball right here?
The one you're holding up in front of the camera? Yeah.
Is this the ball that was in the middle of that maze? Yeah, this is the actual ball right here.
That you tried jumping like 4 feet at a time? Is that what you're doing? Go for the hole! It's an hole!
Oh, I hope they're really not mad at me for taking this, but I kind of got permission, so sort of.
Oh, did you actually take it from the challenge?
This is the ball that sat in the middle of my hole. This is the ball.
All right. Way to go. I don't know how I'm saying, did you sneak it back to camp?
Yeah, and straight into my bag and never to be seen the rest of the season.
Wow, good things Propes doesn't want.
So after they went through Dan's bag, then they went through Mike's bag and said, Mike's got all these challenge artifacts in
here. Yeah.
Hey, I did ask. I'm not going to lie. I asked.
All right, all right.
It was...
Hey, here's our frying pan. Here's our machete. No one has all this stuff.
My best friend, made me a sweet machete that has the Survivor logo, the Worlds Apart logo on it, and then blue collar and all of our names, white collar, no collar. Sick. Nice. Sick machete.
Very nice. Yeah. Very nice.
All right, so after that loss, unfortunately, my blue collar is going to be broken up. So, Lindsay, strategy or harmony?
Harmony.
What was behind her exit? That was my feeling as well. Because, I mean, it could have been who was the other option? Was it Rodney for them? That was the girls wanted was Rodney. Yep. So, but Rodney's still muscle, And if you've had talks with Rodney, have you already had talks with Rodney at this point?
Yeah, we had a strong, we, you know, like me and Kelly had the strongest alliance, obviously. And then, you know, I really, really worked on Dan or worked with Dan, whatever you want to call it. And we developed a good relationship in the beginning part of the game. So, I mean, we were three. The girls were two. You know, they were, Lindsay and Sierra were 100% in lockstep. They were, you know, spending loads and loads of time together all alone. And we just decided we had to break up that couple because if there was something coming up where we were going to be switched around, that those two would always vote together. And if we wouldn't, you know, it's not necessarily good for all of us.
Yeah.
So, you know, but this is all along the time, too, that we, you know, again, a year and a half ago, I'm developing strategies with one of my best friends who's, you know, a huge fan of the show as well. And, you know, we come up with a strategy about, okay, so my initial tribe, how do I keep numbers from my initial tribe if we get split up? And that's where the strategy came in of throwing the challenge. You know, in the game of Survivor, everyone knows there's a stigmata around throwing a challenge in the game of Survivor. I feel like it's a very unutilized strategy, honestly.
Yeah.
If you're doing it for the right reasons, not to just get rid of somebody. But in our particular case, it was so unique. You know, Kelly was the only one over there. We had talked, we had laid groundwork. Okay, I'm going to back up for just a second, and I'm going to look really deeply into the camera because however many people are listening, I'm going to tell you something right now. Listen to this. If you're going on Survivor, before the switch-up happens, have a plan in place of what you're going to do when it gets switched up. I can't tell you how many people that I've watched play this game that have no plan in place for when the switch-up happens. And so, I mean, that's what the deal was with that. I wanted to make sure that we got as many numbers through to the merge as we possibly could.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided that if we had the numbers, we would throw challenges until they whittled the numbers down enough to where we were merged.
Mm-hmm.
And that was at 6. So then we get rid of Lindsay, the split vote, which is a crazy thing to do your very first tribal council ever. By the way, keynote here. The moment that I realized that I was playing Survivor, like actually playing it, we're sitting in tribal council. This is day 12. You know, we're sitting in tribal council, and Lindsay and Rodney are going at it, you know? And I'm just sitting there, like, watching it, and I look over at Jeff, and I'm watching them, and I look over at Jeff, and I'm like, this is such great TV. And it hits me. It's like, you're not sitting on your couch, bro. You're actually sitting on this hard wooden stool.
Yes.
Jeff Probst is right there.
Yeah.
Lock it up. Get it back into the game, you know. But it was a lot of fun, man. That's funny. Of fun.
You said it. You just said it like 7 times. And to me, I don't know everybody's rules for Survivor, but rule number one for me is that it's all about numbers. Because you don't get to the end game without numbers getting to that point. If you don't have numbers, you don't get to the end to make your run. Because you were number one and only one by the end,
yeah.
But to get there, you had to have numbers to get there. Even at the merge, you had to have numbers. So, because after Lindsay goes, we get right to the shuffle.
Yep.
Right to the merge. And of course, it's guys against girls. Yeah, the swap. It's guys against girls in that first challenge, plus Will and Max. But it's pretty much guys against the other team.
No, Max, I love you and Will. I'm kidding. See, that's the thing. See, that's the thing with the dirty right there. Neither one of them would get mad about that comment. They would laugh it off.
Yeah.
Because they know I'm not serious. They know I don't. They know that if I had something ugly or mean to say to them, that I would call them on the phone and go, yo, what the heck? You know?
Right. Yeah. Did it get to 20 to 2 or 1, or did they just end it after like so many points to say it? Well, they're not going to.
Do you
remember the game where they launched the balls and you had to catch them with the nets?
Oh, no. It was actually 5 to 2. It was, yeah.
Oh, it ended 5-2? Okay.
Yeah, ended
5-2. We know that some of those games have different scores and they just edit it a certain way to keep it short or not.
Well, that was the memory challenge. We actually, the game was to 5, but they showed it just to 3.
Oh, okay.
No, the ball challenge, right after the merge, they did the shuffle. They did the balls. Okay.
I was just saying, in the memory challenge that we threw, the game was actually to 5, but they only showed it being a games of three.
Right. But before we get to that, that's next episode.
Right.
Episode five, here's my question. You had the sled and the wrecking ball, where Dan's on the wrecking ball. That challenge. Did y'all ever consider throwing that challenge to make sure Kelly was safe?
Couldn't.
I know. Couldn't. Unless you just stood there and watched the other team.
I mean, we lapped them. You know what I mean? That wasn't just me and Sierra that lapped them. That was the effort of the whole team. I mean, there's no way. I mean, they didn't even touch the wrecking ball by the time Dan had broken the eighth pot.
Right.
You know, but did you ever talk about it in your small group before, not knowing what the challenge was going to be? Did you talk about it?
Yes. When we went in there, that was the discussion. I don't remember if we had like a look or if we were going to tap somebody or, whatever we were going to do. But we were like, hey, we got to figure out what this challenge is before we can say we're going to throw it. But the
a conversation?
Yeah, for sure.
Was that a conversation y'all had before the shuffle, blue collar? Throwing challenges?
Oh, yeah. Okay. We were all down at the river. And that's what, I brought up the idea to Dan, and then he called, everybody's down the river, and he's like, Mike, tell them your strategy. So I was like, okay, well, here's what we're going to do. and Dan's like, that's genius, which,
I absolutely cannot disagree with you.
Where's Dan? Where's Dan?
I agree. With everything you're saying, everything you just said, I agree. I cannot disagree.
No, love Dan. Love Dan.
Well, Dan has much more experience with women than you do.
I mean, I guess. I mean, I'm
just saying.
Not doing so bad over here.
Oh, really? You're not? I actually had a question. Who are you dating right now?
Ooh, so let me answer this question like this. This is how I answer this question. There is someone, and we are courting. We are not dating, which is...
Okay. I know the difference.
There's a difference there. And, if you follow social media, you probably kind of know who that person is, but, follow me on Twitter or Instagram, and you may find out.
All right.
And for those three people left in the world that don't know that handle, what is your Twitter handle?
Oh, it's @youcan'tdothat121. Same for Instagram.
So let me ask you this: was it? And if you don't want to get into this, you don't have to. Was courting a new idea for her?
Not a new idea. At all. She's on board with it. She's very, very intelligent girl. We're just taking it slow. I said this on the red carpet. Somebody asked me a point blank question about it. And, I said, we're friends investigating a friendship. And if it keeps progressing the way it is, I'll tell you like this, the girl is amazing. I like her a lot. Yeah.
All right, so Tina in our chat room, we're not saying this person is this or this person is that, because you got to go to Twitter to find out. She wants to know if you were ever attracted to Sierra.
Oh, Boo Boo's beautiful. Here's the thing though, it's not an attraction of like a dating relationship. Attracted to Sierra for many, many different reasons. She's lovely, like one of the sweetest girls you've ever met in your entire life. She's
inside and out.
Inside and out, yeah.
And the pictures y'all took during our podcast show that she's got quite a sense of humor.
Yes.
She's hilarious.
I love the sword.
Okay, so when me and Sierra and Tyler, there's a weird bond between us three. Like when us three get together, we're literally transported back to being like 12 years old again.
Oh, and yeah,
we're
awesome.
The biggest kids, man. We have so much fun. So much fun.
It's like the three cousins that don't get to see each other, but every so often. But once you do, you just let it go. Now, this, of course, leads into Max is gone. And then, let's see. Well, I guess then we're at the throne challenge part in episode six.
Yeah.
How far did that game – were you and Kelly the last ones in that challenge?
We were not the last ones in that challenge. Sierra and Rodney both had to go a second time.
Was anybody else as obvious as you at throwing?
Wait, were we? No. Oh, gosh. Dude, how do you...
I mean, I'm not an actor, y'all. You know what I mean? Like, oh, gosh.
That was the funniest thing.
I'm like, Kelly. And people have asked. People couldn't hear you. And, you're mic'd up, so they bump your mic up a little bit. It was much more quiet. But you should have seen Jeff Probst's face the first time that he heard me actually saying to Kelly, like, what's happening? You know, he was like, and so... I couldn't tell if he was really, really mad at the point or if he was, you know, just... Because he really acted like he had no idea that it was about to happen.
And, right. I love it. Mike is still looking at a curtain.
Well, you got to hand it to Probst that whenever he figures out that a player is trying something, you know, funky weird, he doesn't give them away.
Yeah.
He lets them do it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that was a lot of rope. That was a lot of rope that could have went, you know. Okay, so think about it this way. Say I don't win this game. You know, that's a lot of rope that CBS has that they could actually hang me with, you know. Like, they could make me look like the dumbest person in the whole wide world.
Right.
So, you know, I mean, it's one of those things, man, that luckily it worked out. Really luckily, yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. I might have just got a text message from... Yeah, I just got a text message.
From?
Someone.
She who may not be named yet?
Yeah, sorry.
And it said? Shut your mouth, stop talking about it?
She might get mad if I read it, actually.
Oh, okay.
No, it's nothing. It's nothing bad whatsoever.
No, but I mean, like, she's watching right now, whoever this is?
She said she was.
So the chat room right now is aglow with a guessing game.
Yeah, well.
Your Twitter is being trolled extremely hard right now.
Yes, I bet it is. I could just imagine what the text said. Shut your mouth or we won't go out to dinner tomorrow.
Get back. No rabbit tracks. Get back on Survivor.
Go make more money.
We are known. Hey, look. If you're a first-time listener to Survivor Talk with D&D, get used to the rabbit tracks.
Oh, we love it. I love it. I love it.
We do like, I mean, you know, there are other podcasts that are just Survivor. Yeah, but we're not that one.
That's not us.
But we're going to go back to Survivor.
Yeah, because David's
Let's go back.
David wants to go.
He's really into this. Let's go, David.
David's got to go to work in about 4 hours, so no, I'm just kidding. No, not really.
Hey, I'm just letting the questions pile up. We'll do them all at the end.
Were you on board to vote out Joe at this point after you threw the challenge, or were you still on the fence about which way to go?
No, here's the thing. Dan Foley gets mad credit for this. I was down to Joe, before we went to the challenge, and Dan had brought up to me Joaquin before we went to the challenge, and I was like, I don't know. Let me think on it. So I went to bed that night after everything was done. In the morning of the challenge, we woke up. I looked at Dan and I said, you know what? I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right. We need to, you know, get rid of Walk because he has Tyler and Mama C, you know. They had talked, you know, a lot about Shireen in a negative light. And it just didn't resonate with me when they were saying stuff about Shireen. Mm-hmm. So I couldn't really tell if they were with Shireen or not, but I knew Tyler and Walk were together. And then watching Walk and Rodney together, and then it all started piling up. And that night, whenever I was sleeping, I woke up about midway through the night. I went and sat by the fire, and I started thinking about everything. And I was like, okay, Joaquin goes, we're sitting at, you know, four and five. So I'm just doing the numbers in my head, and I look at it, and everything just made sense to get rid of Joaquin and not get rid of Joe. And then I started thinking about it from the aspect of, man, I can go to Joe and tell him that his butt is on the line, come in like the savior, and maybe it keeps my name out of the no-callers' mouths for a couple votes when we do merge. Yeah. I mean, this is not hindsight I thought about this after the game's over, and this is something I'm going to tell you. This is legitimate in-game thinking. And so it was always about currying votes, checking in with people, touching base, seeing where everybody's temperature was all the time, you know? So, yeah, going into the challenge, I knew that I wanted Walt gone.
Yeah.
But the day before the challenge is actually when Dan came through. But then there you go. Reference back to the Bible, a little scripture. There is a multitude. Wisdom is found in a multitude of counsel. You know, even if that's, you know, you can find. You don't always have to come up with a plan. Great leaders, great strategists, or whatever, have counsels around them.
Right.
That help them make decisions. So, you know, that kind of sounded like I just called myself great. That's horrible. Please don't think I'm...
No, but it's wise to look at different options. You can't necessarily be focused on one. One person has never been right all the time except for Jesus, but otherwise nobody can be right every time.
Right. But Joaquin, man, that was a huge vote. You know, I mean, he was so social.
Rodney loved you for it.
Oh, my gosh, he was so hot.
That's my next note. My first note for Episode 7 was this the breakup in the beginning of the Axis of Evil? Because this was going to be the main storyline for the next, like, five episodes. And I was telling Dwayne that I used to watch wrestling, and occasionally it still pops up on my TV. And big in Texas, I know. But the wrestling shows, every week, they build up feuds for the big pay-per-view once a month.
Yeah.
And I felt like week after week, we were getting Rodney jabbing Mike taking the jab and getting ready to throw back. And never making contact, but the two big hitters, week after week after week, were getting closer and closer to that pay-per-view event. And I felt the Rodney versus Mike pay-per-view was coming. And we got it in the finale. But to me, that was the big battle coming up.
Was it paid off? Let me ask you, as a fan, was it paid off?
No, because Carolyn ran interference. She took him out for you.
Really?
You think Carolyn took him out for her?
Well, she did in the fire challenge. Yeah.
So, okay.
Mike actually stepped out of the ring and let somebody else take care of his dirty work for him.
Delegation.
No. Hey, you asked the question, it's going to come back with an answer.
I love it.
I thought it paid off. I love the fact that you and Rodney were at each other the whole way to the end.
Okay, did it pay off? Yes, it paid off because, and I agree with Dwayne, I like that you two were faced off the whole time, and at the last minute, you threw him a shot that he never saw coming. Yeah. He never saw it coming, which is why you outwitted, outplayed, outlasted him. You know, because that's just the game. He never saw it coming. He was so torqued at the end, he never imagined him not being in the final. You know, and that...
He didn't. That was the payoff.
His post-game comments were the payoff.
The day that I'm teaching Carolyn how to do the fire, Rodney's writing, like, his final three speech. I thought it was so fitting. I came back, and I was like, Arts and Crafts Day? And he was like, no, I'm writing down things. And I was like, oh.
How many bros did he have on the speech? Did he have... Bros throughout.
You know what? Rodney was extremely articulate and very had some really good thoughts in his final tribal speech. It was pretty. He was up there for an hour.
But you know, I could say this because I don't know if anybody's listening. But I was at a wedding last night where one of the groomsmen gave a toast that went on. If it was 10 minutes long, it was 9 minutes and 30 seconds too long. Wow. And I think Rodney could talk for 30 minutes, and I would laugh through pretty much the whole thing.
Okay, here's the thing. Two things, since we're talking about Rodney, two things I would love to say. Number one, I didn't understand how dangerous Rodney was until I came home and watched the edit.
Oh, nice. You know what
I
mean?
Like, I truly didn't. I knew we were headed for that battle, day one, like you talked about. I knew we were headed for that battle. But I didn't respect his game, his social game, his ability to form this crazy alliance of people that have no, on paper, like, reason for being with each other. Mm-hmm. And he held it together. And that's what's even more impressive to me, is that, man, you know, for a guy that never seen an episode, maybe watched, you know, half of a season before he went on Survivor, you know, he had a really good social game. So take nothing away from the kid. Rodney, I love you, but get better at challenges, bro, and you may be able to win this game one day.
Yeah, really. I mean, if you look at that last tribal council, you couldn't have voted him off because Will wasn't going to vote against him.
Right.
There wasn't any way. So your only chance was to get Carolyn.
I could never get Rodney. I could never pull the numbers to get Rodney. Right. After the vote that took Lindsay out, I had the numbers to get Rodney in that vote early on in the game. But after that point, I never had the numbers to get Rodney again until Final Four. Right. And that was what was so huge about me, whatever you want to call it, turning Carolyn, pulling Carolyn into my alliance, because I needed one. I knew when we were at six that I needed one, and I didn't know who I was going to get, but I finally ended up getting Carolyn, and she voted with me the rest of the game, yeah. You know? So...
Yeah. Oh, I got questions further down the road about stuff like that.
Yeah.
Before we get there, did you ever consider splitting votes when you had eight votes to save Kelly, that would have saved Kelly that night? That never came up?
No, I mean, it came up, but we couldn't trust, or I couldn't trust Will's vote.
That's true, I got you.
So I wasn't willing to put a 4-4, and then it get, you know, brought up like a 5-3, and Kelly or me end up going home in that case. You know, I actually, that vote,
that was where, you know, there was about 6 days where I was just, everywhere I turned, man, I was just running into a wall with my own strategy. Mm-hmm. You know, throwing the challenge, then, you know, testing Will, changing the vote the night as we were going from, it was going to be Haley, changing it from Haley to Jen because of how well Jen performed in that poll challenge. Mm-hmm. You know, those little 3 or 4 days, whatever that was, and then the auction right after, those 4 or 5 days right there, dude, I don't know if I lost my mind. No, I didn't. It just, you know, there were plans that I was making, and sometimes they worked and sometimes they didn't. But the great thing about Survivor is if you can last 3 more days, then you got 3 more days to make repairs to your game.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's one thing I noted between you and Tony that was, I thought was identical in your successful strategy, is that you guys were nonstop. Yeah. Even when you were by yourself and had the immunity necklace, you still were playing. You still were trying to work the numbers in your favor. You're still trying to work to that end game. You know, having the necklace after the challenge, going into a tribal council, gave you the opportunity to look past that tribal council at the final one. Yeah. You know, how can I get these votes in my way? Who can I mess with to get these people out that I don't want sitting with me at the end? So I felt that way about you and Tony, that you guys were hustlers. You just played till the end of the game and you never stopped playing. But that's what you got to do.
That's exactly what you got to do. I mean, we're getting into the part of the game now, which is part of my favorite part, because the first 4 votes on our jury, I knew that those were the most important people in the game.
Yeah.
So, you know, Haley, we'll just run them down real quick. Haley and I would go on boa hunts. You know, we would go look for boas, and this crazy little girl, I love Haley. She, you know, she's fly by the seat of your pants. I mean, she's no collar, but she's deeply, deeply convicted in the things that she feels strongly about. And, I mean, the thing with Haley, it was so funny. She would sleep by the fire every night.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, the wind would blow through, and she would get, like, ash and stuff, like, all over. She'd be, like, just so dirty, but, like, that pale face white dirty.
And here's for all you guys that are listening. She would be beautiful. She would wake up, and, like, she would wake up in the morning and open her eyes, and those beautiful blue, like, deep-set eyes would look at you and her all dirty face, and you're like, oh, my gosh, Haley Ford, go wash your face or do something. Get out of here.
You know, because, I mean, she's so, so pretty, but... you know, developing relationships with Haley, Joe, Jen, Shireen, that's what won me the game. Let's be real, you know, because Carolyn and Sierra and Rodney split the vote, which means I needed 4, and I had those 4 in lock, you know, like locked down. Joe appreciated, in my opinion, the physical aspect of the game. You know, one thing that really, really bonded Jen and Shireen and I was the day after the blow up, like when you see us there in those caves, Shireen is like, we're going to find the idol right now. I don't care. We're going to search all night long, and we're going to look for it. And I was so tired at this point. And I just look at Shireen and Jen, and I was just like, I have it. And they're like, what? And I was like, I have the idol. And they were like, no. I'm like, yeah, I've got it. You know, I don't really feel like going and searching. And that's where Jen and my relationship really turned around. That's really what solidified Shireen and I's relationship, even though, you know, the incident that happened previous to that. Going to play the game of Survivor, if you're not thinking about jury votes when the jury starts, then you are you're failing to plan, which means you're planning to fail.
That's right.
And see, that's where I think Dan was unfortunately completely wrong, and when he told you at Final Tribal that you just didn't care about these people. You know, you cared about yourself, but you didn't care about them. I'm like, I count four right there that I think are pretty good friends with Mike when they left the game.
Yeah.
I think you did care about those people.
For sure.
Exactly. How soon after Joe showed Tyler the clue, that you got the clue from Tyler, did you find that idol?
The time from when I got the clue to finding the idol?
Was it same day, afternoon, or?
Same day, 12 hours later.
And I'm presuming you're hunting for the idol all the time.
All day.
Yeah.
All day, every day. Well, I mean, okay, so there was a lull in about from about day 6 to day 12 or 13 where I didn't go crazy looking for it every day, but I would still go look for it. But no, that day, early in the morning, tracked him down the beach, you know, like they were on the beach and I was on the back path, tracked him the whole way, saw Joe pull out the clue. And the only thing, and I said this on the other podcast, the only thing I could think of was Blitzkrieg. That was the thing that came into my head, so I was just, bam, on it, and I just kind of blitzed him, got on there, and Tyler actually looks down at the pot that he's cleaning, and he looks back up to me, and when he looks back up to me, he's like,
I have to talk to you. He mouthed the word.
And Joe's like, you know, he didn't even see it. So right from that point, we left, and then Tyler goes and, you know, eventually tells me the clue that to find the idol that I play to vote him out.
Wow.
I love you, Ty. Since we are on Tyler, such a funny story. Or at least I think it's really, really, really funny. We were, when we won that Snickers reward, so you saw at the end of the edit where Tyler, like, tackles me into the water, right?
Yeah.
When my head hit the water, Tyler's head smashes into my head and, like, basically almost knocks me out.
Wow. Oh, wow.
When I hit the water and, like came up for air, I was disoriented all, and Tyler actually, like, grabs me.
It saves you.
It, like, pulls me into the dock. And, you know, like, they're pulling. You can literally see them pulling me out of the water, and I'm still kind of, like, whatever. But it was really funny because we were got sacked by a kicker, but tackled by a kicker, whatever. But we're on the boat. These are the kind of fun, done moments that we wish that you guys would have gotten to see. We're on the boat on the way to the Snickers Challenge, and they've got the Cineflex, or everybody, that's inside information for the helicopter, Cineflex. So they have the helicopter come flying by, which you're not supposed to look at or wave at, and Tyler and I get up at the end of the boat, and we're doing the Titanic, you know, like, And I mean, it's the most homoerotic thing that you've ever seen in your entire life, and neither one of us are of that way, it was, you know, it's just so much fun being a kid, being dumb, having a good time, and really, really wish that more of that would have gotten seen, more of the gameplay would have gotten seen, you know. But hey, we signed contracts that said show whatever you want to show.
Yeah. And they tell the story they want to tell.
And they're really, really good at it. Take nothing away from that. They are really good at what they do. I mean, amazing. Hey, by the way, just quick plug. Love you, Jeff. Love you, Mark. Love you, CBS.
I'm available for future seasons.
Not for a year or so, at least.
All right. I got a behind-the-scenes question for you.
Okay.
In that challenge that ended in a puzzle, how many times did Dan really get it wrong? Was it just the two, or was it more than two?
Two. Okay. Yeah, but he also, you got a, I think the first time, 15 or 20 seconds.
Really?
And then the second time, I think was maybe, they might not have changed it. I could be remembering that wrong, but I think there was a more delayed penalty for the second time. But, you know, Dan, he said at the end that it was so funny. He was like, all I saw was colors. And I'm like, well, there's words on those colors, Dan.
Yeah.
What do you mean a delayed penalty? He got delayed from restarting?
Yeah. Like, before he could touch his puzzle again, he had like a 15-second penalty.
Oh, wow.
That he had to serve. So, yeah, that was a fun. By the way, I've really practiced slide puzzles since I've been home.
Yeah.
Seriously. I'm so mad. Anyways, that's good. That was a fun challenge.
So at the chocolate reward challenge, anybody go looking for a clue?
Oh, dude, we tore that whole place apart.
I'm not joking. We were sitting down at the table and everything, and I was like, okay, guys, I can't handle this anymore. And they were like, what? And I got up and found this big bowl and just started pouring all of those M&Ms in this one bowl to see if clues were coming out. if you rewatch that episode, you'll see me when we walk up. Like, I take my hand and I rake all the candy bars down into like one pile to see if there's a clue in there. You know what I mean? Like, that's actually in the edit.
I was looking for somebody to go, I want this one. No, this one. No, this one. No, this one.
Dude, I went, anytime I was anywhere that there was possibly a clue, like Final Three or the helicopter deal, I was always looking for clues, man.
Right.
When we won the sausage and the plant, you know, right after the swap, when it was six guys, one girl. Dude, we go to pick up all the stuff. Look at what I go pick up. I go pick up the crate with everything in it. The whole way back, walking back to the van, I'm looking through this crate to see if there's a clue. I even walked by Dan, who's holding the tree plant, and I looked all the way through the tree as he's carrying it. You know, like, I mean, dude, Mama didn't raise no fool. You know, right. In the game of Survivor that there's going to be a clue. You just keep looking.
Yeah, that's right.
Let's see. So after that episode 9, we're getting there. After episode 9, every individual challenge going forward is either Carolyn or you. After episode 9. Carolyn gets two individual ones, not groups, just individuals. Just because Tyler won that one.
Yep.
So Joe got knocked out that episode. And then you get into episode 10, and that's where you appear, according to the edit, to overhear the Axis of Evil.
I did overhear.
And you say, you know, what brings these people together? Well, if they all have the same target, if they all have the same enemy, the one strong person against them, that will bring different folks together.
Yeah. Well, you know, the thing with that whole alliance, Joe was still in the game when I actually overheard the very, very first conversation.
Okay.
And that conversation was between Carolyn and Rodney, I believe.
Two very soft-spoken people. Gotcha.
Yeah. Well, it was, I mean, they were whispering. You know, that was one key to my game, and I'm throwing this out there, and I'm sure people will really pay attention if I ever do get to play again to this, but, you know, I play possum a lot and act like people, you know, like I couldn't hear people or I wasn't paying attention or something like that. And
right.
I was always paying attention, you know, or trying to anyways, because the more information that you have in the game of Survivor, the stronger and smarter you are as a player.
So you had like a mobile spy shack. You didn't just have one. You were
all over the place. Yeah. I think people at some point in the game like legitimately just thought I went crazy. So at that point they were just like, well, we'll just talk around him. He's going home anyways.
That's right.
He had a straight jacket waiting for him at Tribal Council. Yeah.
There's no way he's going to win 5 challenges. We'll get him out sooner or later.
This guy.
Hey, I accidentally missed a question that had to do with the throwing the challenge.
Ah, okay.
Stephen Meatforth. He wrote, did the other tribe recognize you through the memory challenge for Kelly?
No. Okay. No one knew that we actually threw it till I think there was like 6 or 7 people left in the game, and then Rodney told Carolyn. I'm like, Rodney, even though we're on the opposite sides of each other, that's not something you want to tell the jury or anybody that's going to possibly be on the jury.
That's right.
It's like a secret, bro. Oh, man. So funny.
Oh, man.
I forgot to ask you in the very beginning, since you were thinking the whole game, I'm sure, looking at your tribe, and anybody else, who was your initial final three? Do you remember? Who's that?
Kelly, Sierra, and myself.
Okay. At this point, Kelly's gone. Joe just left. You're getting ready to go to auction. Do you have a mobile final three? Is it flexible? Or I see your wallet.
It's my wallet. It's my Survivor auction wallet.
It should still have some stuff in it.
Well, it doesn't have. The only thing it has in it, I'll show you, is my day 39 tag that says I was 188 pounds when I went in the game, which is not true. Not true. I went in the game at 215, but this was the game. What they actually did was this is like some different weight when we weighed in at some other time.
Oh.
But yeah, it's actually empty. There's nothing in it, but it's a cool little leather wallet.
Nice. So does that answer the question that you put on poundage before going on for good measure?
Yeah, I put on 25 pounds of muscle and fat. I stopped working out 2 weeks before Survivor, and I'm not joking whenever I say this, I ate cupcakes. Like cupcakes and jars of peanut butter. There's a cupcake place right by my house.
Yeah.
Those the most amazing cupcakes that you've ever eaten your entire life. And I would down probably like 12 cupcakes a day, bro. I got a good old gut going before I went on Survivor. Yeah.
Tony talked about his peanut butter diet too. He was
peanut butter jars. Put it on, dude. It's good. It sticks to your bones.
Just in case, I have one at my desk right now. So anyway.
Yeah.
hey, it fills you up. If you're hungry and you don't want to eat something, just try a spoonful of that stuff.
Are we gonna get into the auction part?
That's next.
Let's do it.
Let's see.
Uh-oh. Did I mess anything up just then?
Okay. No.
I hear you.
Okay. Good.
So you got that wallet and it's full of green, and you have no intentions of eating, do you?
Mm-hmm. Not eating that day.
Who else was not eating, if I remember? Was it Carolyn and Dan?
Carolyn, Dan, and oddly enough, Tyler saved all of his money because he thought after the advantage was going to be pushed out or put out that there was going to be something else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So instead of throwing his money in the ringer for a 25% chance at the draw on the White Rock, he let us have it at 33%. And kept his money for a cruise that he took his beautiful wife Jess on after the game. Yeah.
Nice.
So we get to the point where I'm
he's
glad
he's rewards.
Yeah. I'm glad he Probst didn't say, all right, let's just forget the rest of the food. Get right to it. He did do a few things. We got to see people eat a few things. Mr. Rodney, who never eats, got to eat a steak and some other stuff.
Jen Brown was pissed. She was. Mad, y'all. When we got back to camp, she was like, y'all know there was more food at the auction. Y'all ruined it for us because y'all were just trying to go for the advantage. You know? There's nothing there for vegans to eat. She's not a vegan, but, you know, like, she wanted some nachos or something like that.
Yeah.
And then I kicked over her, like, she had, like, legitimately, like, this much alcohol left in the bottom of her drink.
And whenever something happened, I don't remember what it was. I think we were getting up for the letters or whatever. I kicked her drink over.
You were already having a bad time back at camp, and then you kicked her drink over.
Dude, I never admitted to it until like the night she was going home when she was like, just write my name down. I was like, I kicked over your drink. She goes, I know.
Well, can I still get your vote at Final Trouble?
we'll talk about that, how I locked that up later. Okay. Or we can talk about it now, whatever.
Well, let's do the letters.
Okay, let's do them.
How did that go down? Did he answer Carolyn when she went up to get her money back? Did he make any comments there, or was it just left until you made a decision?
Yeah, I think he just kind of sat there. He did say at one point, he was like, Mike, I don't know that I'm okay with this.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But you know, ultimately, we all know Jeff's the orchestrator of it. What he says goes.
He's the end all say all. Yep.
And yeah, and so I think if I would have ended up sticking with the strategy of taking the advantage and not the letters, I think he would have probably just let us do it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like not let Carolyn have her money back because I spoke up and said something. But if I would have been quiet and not said anything, which that's not really in my character. I would have spoke up and said something. I think his hands would have been forced and tied, because in the game of Survivor, when do you get anything for free, let alone when you bought something and they're not going to give it back to you? You know, I can't imagine.
Well, if you could go back and do that moment again, what would you do different? Or would you do anything different?
Yeah, I would just not give my word saying that I was not going to not do it. Yeah, you know, I would still pull the same move. I feel like the strategy was strong with that move, but in that moment, I really, really, really did give my word to Dan.
Yeah.
That would be where I would change it. I just would have never said, yeah, I'm going to do it. You know, hey, if you want your letter and that's that important to you, then, you know, get the letter. I'm going for the advantage. Yeah. You know. Yeah.
Of course, you didn't know you were going to win all but one challenge going forward. You
know, true story. I also thought that advantage was going to be Tony's idol. You know, I really did the quote-unquote Tyler Perry idol, which is mm-hmm. Yule's idol. It's just renamed.
Horribly. Go ahead.
Yeah, horribly. Exactly. I agree. Medina finds a hidden immunity idol.
That's a movie. Medina plays Survivor.
Yeah.
Medina goes to Survivor. In the game of Survivor,
goes up on a reward.
Yeah, you make. No, I'm just trying to think. You make plans in the game of Survivor, and I think it's a lot like life. You make plans, and sometimes they're a great plan, sometimes they're a bad plan, but you're left up to your own, you know, devices to carry this plan out, whether it's a good plan or a bad plan. And I think the really, really big aspect of my game was that I was really able to rebound from mistakes. I think that's probably the end story of my game, is that I would make a mistake and then I would rebound. And, I mean, that's just like this, dude. I got this nice black $480 rock. You know? I mean, it's got little red flakes in it, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know. I don't look at this rock as failure. You know what I look at this rock as? I look at this rock as a learning experience of, hey, why don't you develop better strategy so you don't need to have this rock next time?
Yeah.
Hey, so are you a spokesman for Teflon yet?
Oh, yeah, Dan calling me Teflon Mike. No, that's funny.
Now, I forgot to mention, I think we're already past it, but one of my favorite moments this season came from you, of course, my pick to win it all. But anyway, not like Blaine's. But one of my favorite moments was you. Was it spur of the moment that you called out Joe saying that he'd found the idol? I love that you played that so hard, reflected everything back on him. You guys know he just came from a reward, you know, and that was great. I love that moment.
I had to have. I went on a walk, and I came back from the walk, and Dan's like, I can't find Joe. And I'm like, what do you mean you can't find? You know, you. Nine of you guys had one job and one job only, and that was to watch Joe. I can't watch him all the time, you know. And I come back and so running around finding Joe, and I was like, "What? How can you get this guy to stop looking for the idol, so that you can find it?" Mm-hmm. And the only thing I could think of was run out there in front of everybody and say that he found it, because hopefully that'll make him stop looking for it. Because then he'll, you know, want to keep up the ruse that he has it. And number two, it'll make everyone else not looking for it because they feel like he has it.
So you didn't have it at that time?
No, I didn't have it, no.
Oh,
no.
I got you.
I found it later that day.
Okay.
Right. I found it on day 21. You know, but yeah, like, no, I had to have, and when they all stopped looking for it, it was 2 hours after they all stopped looking for it when I actually found it.
Wow.
That day, yeah.
Well, it worked.
Got really, really, really fortunate, man.
Yeah.
Now, I forgot to ask when we were at the auction, how did you feel when Will paid that money and was told to go back to camp? Because my heart just dropped. As a Survivor fan, to see somebody actually pay to be sent out of the auction without a chance for food? Or were you actually happy with one less person to bid on stuff?
I mean, either way, it didn't matter to me because I had one focus, one goal in mind, and that was to get that advantage. So right. I had gone into that mentally prepared to sit there and smell everyone else's food the whole time, watch them enjoy it, and get the advantage. I mean, that was the game plan going in, and I knew it, and I was starving. But, I mean, you know, it's 39 days. I can be hungry for 39 days. I can do anything for 39 days.
Right.
If you're not completely 100% focused on winning in that prize, then you've already lost the game, in my opinion.
Right.
Yeah, you got to be willing to suffer. I mean, that's what you're doing, to play a game. It's a suffering game. It's not about being happy or being comfortable. It's about suffering.
Well there's a saying. Go ahead. Go ahead, sorry.
Was there a brief moment, though, before you figured out what it was that you thought, oh, no, that's the advantage? Whenever Will bought the very first thing.
Yes. I was like, did they just pull the biggest blindside in Survivor history on us? And then when he's opening up, like, I'm actually peeking over his shoulder so I can read it, too.
Yeah.
And he's like, dude, just bought yourself out of this auction. I was like, oh, thank God.
Yeah, because I was thinking, wow, they just gave the advantage right up front. What a great idea.
Which is a spectacular idea.
I know. I don't know why they didn't do it.
Well, I thought was ironic what Will got, had he kept it to himself, could have actually been seen as an advantage that Probst was describing, because he said it's an advantage to give someone an advantage late in the game. Had he kept it all to himself, he's got food and electrolytes for the rest of the game. He has a late game advantage.
I'll just be honest with you guys, as nice as a person as I am or whatever, probably not sharing that.
That's what David and I were saying.
Yeah.
Probably. Because, I mean, I actually did buy it at the auction. It is for me. It's not something that I got, like, you know, with a net, like it's a fish and I'm going and hiding it, the fish, and cooking it by myself. It's not like that. It's not like community food. You guys all got a chance to eat at the auction. This is, you know, I had to leave the auction. I didn't get my letters. This is my reward. I probably wouldn't have shared. I don't know. Maybe I would have, you know. I might have went and prayed the next morning and God been like, yo, you need to share that, or, you know, sitting there or whatever. Yeah. But, you know, it's such a fine line, this game of being, you know, selfish, being giving, being compassionate, being abrasive, all of those things, negative and positive connotations in your life that you would do without thinking, have greater effect and consequences in the game of Survivor than just in your normal day life.
Yeah. So later in the game, you admit trying to stir up things when you're the Lone Ranger playing by yourself. Now, at this point, are you actually thinking that there might have been more in that reward for Will than what he brought out, or were you just looking to stir up? Because it's a great stir-up conversation.
Oh, no, I thought there was way more food. Like, that cooler, when we found that cooler, I was like, bro, he did get sandwiches, finally. Somebody?
No, I mean, I was really, really...
So y'all went and dug it up?
Yeah, we walked right over to it. Like, okay, so another thing. During the day, some days you're just so bored because there's nothing to do. So we were like, let's go on a treasure hunt. You know, let's go on an adventure. And so we walked basically right over to it. We saw this little post laying on the ground. And we were like, no way. He just left this post sitting right here. Sure enough, he left it sitting right by the box. We dug it up and just left it uncovered. Like, we didn't even cover it back up. We just left it uncovered so somebody would walk by it and see it.
I wonder why he reburied it.
Yeah, I don't know. That's really strange. But no, that's all the food that he had. He was very generous with that. Thanks, Will.
Yeah. How long did it last?
Oh, Rodney had that stuff done in like half a day.
Gosh.
I mean, don't get me wrong. We all ate it, but even Will, if Will came on here, he would tell you. He'd be like, yo, I had to tell Rodney to slow down. He was eating it every 2 seconds. It was just I'm getting no rewards, bro. No rewards. I can't do it. I'll try, but.
Well, he can do you, but you can't do
it. Oh, my gosh. He's great.
Yeah.
So
much better than you do me, by the way.
Shut me up.
Amen to that.
It shut me up.
I'm thankful so far. Has it come up good? Yes. But here we are at one of the most uncomfortable moments.
Mm.
Do you remember how did that come about? How did that go down from your point?
Well, so basically here's how it happened. We had left that thing uncovered. And so leaving it uncovered, Will and Sierra and Rodney went and found it. And once again, I'm going down along the back path, and I'm all hiding, like looking through trees, listening. And Will actually sees the camera crew or me, whatever, hiding out. And he's like, you know, don't be a bee, Mike. Come out here or whatever. And so they dig up the thing, and they're walking down the.
So he already knew at this point that y'all were talking about him not sharing everything?
No.
Oh, he didn't.
No, he did. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you're right. He did know. So they're coming back to camp, you know, him and Rodney, and I ran back into camp real quick because Jim Brown had made popcorn, which is coconut that's, you know, burnt, and it kind of tastes like popcorn. It's awesome. I came running back into camp, and Jen's in there. She just got done cooking the popcorn, and I was like, yo, it's about to go down. So she grabs herself and starts hightailing it to the caves, and I'm pretty real close behind her because I'm not sticking around for this. I get about halfway to the caves, and I hear just yelling at the top of my lungs, and I know it's Will. And the only thing I can think is, like, Shireen just came back from a walk or whatever, and she's walking into a hornet's nest. So I turn around, and I run back into camp. And by this time, you know, it's full on. It's not just Will, you know. I mean, you know, like, there was a couple different things that were said. And I just walk in and I'm like, dude, you're not going to sit through this. We're not going to listen to this. And, you know, we almost get all the way out of camp. And I think Will said one more thing and it just, you know, blew up from that point, which was even worse. But, you know, that was the moment in the game that Shireen stood up for herself. You know, she had just sat there and took so much. And, you know, in that moment, she stood up and faced, I guess you could call it, her attacker. But, you know, there was a moment in there that I really respected. I really took a step back from Shireen and go, you know, this is bigger than this game. This is a love relationship that is forming between two people that should have no relationship in this world whatsoever to begin with, but, you know, through circumstances and whatever, you know, we're able to come together. And I love that girl, man. I love that girl so much. I hope she does so amazing on Second Chances. But, you know, it was an ugly situation, not to glaze over the situation, but also not to give it as much time as, you know, we've already seen about it as well. Mm-hmm. You know, it's still an ongoing issue. I hope at one point in time that they can both get it resolved and that it can actually be a non-issue anymore. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm come from a very troubled past. I come from, you know, being abused. I come from being sexually molested as a kid. I come from, you know, getting beat up at school and bullied and stuff, you know. But God, through His grace and mercy, has healed me from all of those things. But at the same time, like, it's my responsibility to stand up mm-hmm. for injustice in situations, and that's a hot button issue for me because, you know, growing up it was tough. But, you know, coming to find Christ at 15 years old and then going through my teenage years and being angry about everything, and then really, really, really understanding the love of Christ and His forgiveness and forgiving those that did those things to me. Man, it's been such a huge weight that was taken off my chest and freedom, you know, so much freedom because bitterness only hurts one person, yourself. It doesn't hurt anybody else. So I mean, if you're out there and you're listening to this and you got unforgiveness in your heart for somebody, you know what? It's probably a pride issue in you that you're not willing to forgive them. Forgive them, let it go, see what happens, man. You know, because life's too short to hate anyone or to be bitter about anything. Yep. Sorry, I'll get off my soapbox. Apologize.
No, that's what we talked about at the beginning.
I agree.
About this little thing is not in the scope of life. This little thing is not worth holding on to.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Good stuff. Good stuff. All right, David.
Where are we
at? Back on where you want to be.
One real quick shout out though to Joe and his hidden immunity idol, fake hidden immunity idol. I am the only person that has this extremely unique distinction as a player, and I love this distinction. I have held Bob Crowley's fake hidden immunity idol in my hand, and I have held Joey Amazing's fake hidden immunity idol in my hand. And I have to tell you, Bob's was burned up, obviously, because Jeff threw it in the fire. But even if it wasn't, this idol made by this kid on the island
looked amazing.
Was so sick. Even me having that clue that I showed you guys earlier and having the idol.
You were still worried about it.
I'm like, Jeff, can you just tell me real quick? You did it for Tony. Can you just tell me real quick that this is, you know, like a real idol or what, you know? But, oh, man, that was an intense moment. And him handing it to me at Tribal Council.
Yeah.
Like, you're just trying to put me on blast in front of everybody, right?
Yeah.
So when did you see it first? Outside the Tribal Council or at Tribal Council?
When he handed it to me, that was the very first time I saw it at Tribal Council as we walked in. So
did you have a blink of a fantasy for a moment? I've got two idols on my pocket.
I was feeling so much like James, the gravedigger. Love you, James, even though you're never going to see this. But I don't see James as watching too many podcasts.
No. Let's see. That was the last one that Jen goes after the auction episode.
Ooh, Jen. Let's bring up Jen.
Talk about Jen. How'd you like that vote?
So one night we were sitting around the this is really cool. I've not told anybody in the press this story, I don't believe. So you guys are getting the exclusive.
All right.
One night we're sitting around the camp and fire and Jen and I are talking. And I was like, man, I'm going to go to Tribal Council in my underwear one night. She's like, no, you won't. And I was like, Jen, I don't care. I mean, I'm on national TV already all the time in my underwear. And so we made a deal that night that if either one of us made the final Tribal Council, that we would drop trowel at final Tribal.
Nice.
So she gets up to do her speech at final Tribal. And, I mean, I stand up and just drop trowel in front of everybody. You know? I'm just sitting there in my underwear, and I sit back down, and Jeff said something or whatever, and I took them all the way off, and I'm sitting back down just in my underwear, and Jeff goes, Mike, do you think you could put those back on? And I'm like, why? Like, I'm doing this. And Jen's like, no, put them back on. And I'm like, why? And Jeff's like, because we can see –
oh,
of your shorts, of your underwear.
Jim was like, please put them back on.
Please, that's 38-year-old man disgust. I'm 23-year-old hot mama. I don't need to see that.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, so, you know, and Jen cracks up laughing, and before she goes on her, you know, speech, which we'll get into that in just 1 second, she laughs and she goes, you know, if you didn't have my vote before, you got it now. And then she turns to the jury and starts telling her jury speech.
Right.
The really interesting thing about this was a year, like I said, whenever I was training and all this stuff, I prayed. I prayed specifically for my Spencer. And I even have told my friends that and everything. The exact same thing that Spencer did for Tony, Jen Brown did for me at that final Tribal. And I can't overvalue it. Like, you know, being a Christian, the small things that you pray for, God hears.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this was, you know, years in the making that, you know, I mean, I prayed for this, and it comes to life. And God bless Jen Brown for standing up for me in that moment. You know, there were a lot of people that I felt like I stood up for in the game, and there was only two that stood up for me. You know, six in the end that wrote my name down, but two in the game. You know, Jen and, of course, Shireen with her beautiful, beautiful speech, which is really strange. I watched it all over again today, and I know this sounds sappy and stupid, but I started crying all over again. You know, yeah. I mean, we have a love connection, that girl and I, that, you know, don't get it twisted. It's not a romantic thing. But we have a connection that we will always be bonded in life. And she and Jen taking that moment, stand up for me, means more to me than winning the game, honestly.
Awesome.
All right, so this is a good time for this question.
Yeah.
All right, we're not talking about the finale at back in L.A. And take out your mom's visit.
Okay.
What was your favorite moment of the 39 days? If you can pick one. I'll let you pick two if you really have to.
No, I already know it. Favorite moment was the orphanage reward. Being there with those kids. I love kids. Love kids.
Wait a second. You mean the helicopter ride the next time wasn't better?
No, man. There was a moment.
You were still playing during that helicopter ride. Look, Will, look out the window. Isn't this great?
Yeah.
We're on Survivor.
I remember Carolyn said after the helicopter ride that it was the best.
Oh, she did? I was joking on her
during the podcast about, really, better than the orphanage from the week before.
No, I forgot about that. Yeah, but, there was a moment that there was a four-year-old kid there, five-year-old boy, that I picked up and started, you know, dancing, doing a two-step with. And you know, our eyes locked, and it was a human moment. That's the only way I can describe it.
Yeah.
And it was more real to me than a lot of moments in my life. That's gonna go down as looking into his eyes. I see that kid's eyes almost every night whenever I go to bed. Mm-hmm. And that was such a crazy fun experience, such an awesome day, and just being able to be there and give back. I'm not just saying that to be cool or to make people think that, you know, more. That is what life's about. That's what this experience is about.
Right.
This experience is about, you know, showing, you know, how God has blessed me in my life, but also to take time to give back to our community, mm-hmm. give back to less fortunate people. And it was awesome experience.
That's awesome that your favorite moment in a 39-day game was a moment outside the game almost. It was you being able to step just for a moment outside the game after the hustle and bustle of 39 days, a moment that allows you to step out of it and really have a reality check, you know, just a life moment was your favorite moment of being in the game of Survivor.
Yeah, that was definitely not only just my favorite moment, but a very growing moment as well.
Did you get to teach him the happy dance?
No, I just did. I taught him some two-step, some Texas two-step.
All right, so from a high moment to a low moment, what was your least favorite moment of the 39 days?
Probably the day that Shireen or Kelly, one of those two, went home. Yeah. Kelly for a certain amount of reasons because, you know, loved her. She was, you know, my closest ally. Great sounding board, friend, and confidant, partner in crime, if you will. And then Shireen. Wow, because after that, nobody talked to me for like a couple of days, and I had nobody, and that was tough. That was really, really tough.
There's so many little things in this game that happen. That, like, Dan went in that advantage, I think, actually hurt him later on in the game.
For sure.
But the moment of you separating yourself from your original alliance actually gave you the opportunity to bond with Jen and Shireen, who left the game with their heads held high and smiles on their faces.
Yeah, I know.
And I feel it was because they left knowing that someone they liked was still in the game.
Yeah.
And who knows if you'd have gotten that chance, if you'd have still been I think you would have socialized anyway, but because you were ostracized from your original group, you were given to that group, and you made new friends that sat on the jury and waited for their chance to wave their mic banners.
Yep.
You know, and it's so neat, that little thing. I love seeing those little things in Survivor that just flip the whole game on its head.
Oh yeah.
And that was to me a great edit part. I give him a lot of credit for that edit that they showed that. They showed the transformation that every step you went through to get to that moment that lead to your win.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. I knew at a certain point that I had to get away from Rodney. You know, because if I was going to be tied to Rodney all the way to the end, I didn't want it to be seen as he was playing my game or I was playing his game. I wanted it to be seen that you don't ever want to sit at the end with somebody that played a similar game, because right, then the people have to decide who played the better of the similar game.
Right.
Not that he played a similar game than I did, but he started off the same place that I was. He was a hustler. He's definitely an alpha male.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but there just had to be some separation in between us. And
right.
I thought he played an aggressive game. I just didn't think his batting average was very high. I didn't think a lot of his stuff came to it. So he went up to bat a lot, but yeah. Just didn't make a whole lot of contact. And you went up there by yourself with nobody batting behind you and just kept hitting home runs.
Yeah.
Well, so, you know, I mean, I'm walking.
Yeah, we're getting a tour of Mike's house right now.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, look at this. My best friend made this awesome, like, hat rack thing. I wish it would be a little bit.
Wow.
I'm going to look at the front yard for a second while we're talking.
Okay.
Which is
the shelter out there that you bought?
Which is home? Code for 10-1, and 10-1 means you're peeing. So okay. You're actually getting a live exclusive of me.
I so do not really think you're peeing outside.
Hey, this is a 3-hour podcast right now, dude. I have to pee. Okay.
Better than hearing the flush.
So, hey, listen, I'll tell you like this. This may make me weird or whatever, but I would much rather pee outside than inside any day of the week.
Well, he did it for 39 days, so he's pretty comfortable with it.
Yeah, I'm pretty confident in my ability to hit the grass.
So is it safe to assume that Rodney was never in your final three?
Rodney was never, ever, 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 ever in my final three.
Who was, since with Kelly gone, who was your final three at this point? We're talking when Shireen left.
Dan, Sierra, and me, because I was still blue collar.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that was my final three. What am I looking for? Oh, yeah. Dude, I got to show you guys something. Seriously.
All right.
This is the best part of the podcast.
I found these yesterday, or 2 days ago. These are magical.
Lay's wasabi vinegar kettle cooked.
Wasabi ginger.
I'm telling you right now, sorry. Wasabi ginger.
Nice.
What's up? Sorry. Go ahead.
So, are you going to eat those during the podcast?
No, I'm having to wait because they're too crunchy. They're too crunchy to eat during the podcast.
I was just thinking of the extra hour I get to spend editing out the crunches. No,
but I have, you know, like I said, I'm not like the most perfect Christian or in the world, but I'm probably maybe about to put a dip in. Yeah, I work in the oil and gas industry, man. You know, we dip snuff. Sorry.
There you go.
Just to confirm, you had never had any intention of playing your idol for Shireen.
Never.
No. Yeah, obviously. Just confirming.
You can't always protect everybody, even if you want to.
Right.
You know, with Shireen, there was a limitation of how far I could actually protect her and take her in the game.
Right.
Because if I use that idol that night for her, then I am unprotected the very next tribal council, and I go home.
That's right.
Which I didn't really feel like going home. Like Joe said when he was walking out, I'm not really ready to go home yet.
Right.
Right. And as funny as it was, I think that actually earned you more points with Shireen. She respected the fact that you were going to stay in with all the armor you could have.
Yeah. She loved that lady.
Well, yeah. I told Shireen, this is really funny. I told Shireen going into that, I was like, listen, I'm not going to tell you what's going to happen at tribal tonight. You know, but she knew I had the idol. I said, but be ready for something to happen because I need a genuine reaction out of you. That's why I'm not telling you what it is. But she knew. She's smart. I mean, come on. This girl went to Brown University. She developed Google Calendar. You know what I mean? This girl's smart. So, I mean, she figured it out. And I love her skipping to the voting urn. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, she's just like, whoa. I mean, that's Shireen. You know, she's so quirky and cagey that if she is able to control her fandom, control the little nuances of being annoying, that I think that she really, really learned in this season, she could go really, really deep in this next season, because I think the guys are going to – if I was drafting for this season, I would draft all girls. That would be my – I think a girl wins this next season. I don't know who.
I want to talk about that in a few minutes.
I got
similar thoughts on that too.
See where are we at.
How frustrating was it that Dan and Sierra wouldn't listen to you when you were trying to tell them what was going on?
It's like you're a cop, and you're sitting at this stop sign, and you see people just keep rolling through the stop sign, and you're like, yeah, you know what, I'm going to let them go. But then there's this one punk kid that's blaring his music, and he rolls through the stop sign and does everything that everybody else does, and you just go and pop him. You know what I mean? Just because he's that one young punk kid. And I have no idea where this analogy's going.
I don't either.
And by pop, you mean give a ticket.
Yes, yes. Is there another definition?
I just want to make sure no one can use it in a bad way.
Got you. Good call on that. No, it was so frustrating in the fact that it ultimately boiled down to me having to show Dan and stop telling him, because I went so many different times and told Sierra and him, yo, they're coming for me, I know what's going on, listen to me, no, you're crazy. No, I'm not crazy! You know what I mean?
You have the audacity to tell me! Sorry, that was my Dan
impression. No, I love it.
Now I have bruises.
I'll come over and rub them for you. Don't worry about
it. No, that's quite all right. All right, David, where are we? Because I have questions, but I don't want to, you know, mess up your...
Well, in the timeline, we are at the challenge that I think Mike would definitely have beat me at, where you hold the rope and lean back. And I loved how Will and Dan were just looking for where they were going to fall. They weren't looking for time. They weren't looking for food coming out. They were just making sure there was a soft water spot behind them when they fell. How hard was that challenge for you?
Sucks. I hate any endurance challenge in Survivor to begin with. I mean, hats off, number one, to Joe for winning that pole challenge. That's ridiculous. Him and Mama C. The next one, you know, me and Mama C split. Or no, we didn't. Tyler won the next endurance challenge with the block. And then the next one, me and Mama C won. That one is so dumb, because I'm not going to make excuses. Mama C, you are a stud. But my hands were still numb, or have been, all the way up until about a week and a half before the finale aired. I went in and grabbed like this piece of wood and burned. I've got this sweet little scar on my pinky right there. So here's all the excuses of why I didn't win, other than Mama C is a beast, especially at that challenge. I mean, for real. I couldn't have, even had my hands been good and my strength been good and been fed and all that, she still would have beat me. That's such a tough, tough challenge. Hate it.
She's a fit bit as it is, but I mean, those challenges are perfect for I call that the Monica Culpepper challenge. I mean, that's just...
Oh, yeah.
And you look at Carolyn, she's built. I mean fit. I'll say fit. She is. You can tell she works out. You can tell she takes care of it. And she just dominated. You know, give her a lot of credit.
Called her yoga lady. Her, Tyler, and Sierra and I were all in the first round of casting in April. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you got 7th, you got 5th, you got 1st and 2nd, all in the same casting pool.
Wow. You know,
that's a pretty deep casting pool. And I mean, I started calling Mama C yoga lady over a year before I ever played the game with her, or 6 months before I ever played the game with her.
Yeah.
You know?
And funny enough, this is the episode where they kind of brought Carolyn back into the game, other than being part of Rodney's axis. She wins, and then she makes the big move to join you and vote out Tyler. That was huge. We got a chance to talk to Tyler. Dwayne did. And I'm not sure if – I think he mentioned in that interview where you, it's kind of a toss-up which way you can play, no matter how you want to play. You can play on the outside or you can be the voice, loud voice on the inside, so to speak. And he had talked about, you know, with Rodney in the middle and so many characters in the middle, he felt like he could roam the outside and pick up the pieces and play from there out in. And it made sense, but it seemed like almost once you were ostracized, you were on the inside. You know, everybody was looking at you. He's target number one, and it just that's when people got to start picking off others. Did you think Carolyn – well, of course you didn't think she did because you wanted Tyler gone too.
Mm-hmm. No, I was going for Tyler way before anybody else was.
Yeah.
Tyler had this unique ability to point out your faults to everyone else. Mm-hmm. In a way that it was like, oh my God, do you see him doing that? But not in a way where like, he was tattletelling, in a way that people were like, oh my gosh, I do see him doing that. Oh, Tyler, how are we going to work this out, you know?
Yeah.
Tyler was very, very smart in the game. He was just unwilling to take chances, and that's Tyler's biggest downfall in the game of Survivor.
Getting Carolyn and Sierra... Here's the thing I don't understand. How does the guy that's on the bottom, that is on the outs, ostracized, how did the last four votes of the game, how does that guy get who he wants to go home every single vote? I don't understand. I'll never understand like why they just decided to vote with me and stuff. I mean, thank God they did because, I mean, ultimately you get Tyler out of the game, which was a competitor threat to beat me, and Sierra. You know, I'm skipping Dan, I understand, but as far as challenge threats go, those are my two threats to keep me from winning the rest of the immunities. And you would think that the people would want to keep around someone that had a better chance of beating me in the end, but,
right.
You know, I mean...
Well, yeah, I could see that. I could see getting rid of people... That's obviously not themselves, but when you got a guy that's not going anywhere, and you can affect the vote that way, you know, as soon as you lose, they're safe again.
Exactly.
So why not put themselves in a place where they're still safe by joining numbers? Because again, it's all about numbers. You know, if you can get the numbers in the right way, you know, you're the right size.
And why not join me and earn my jury vote for when you feel like I'm gonna go anyways?
And see. Exactly, and that's to me why you put Carolyn in the fire challenge, because if she loses, you get her jury vote because you did her a favor. You did her the only favor to keep her in the game. If she wins, she's still on the jury. I mean, she's still in the game. But if she loses, she went out on her own because you didn't vote her out. She went out with an honorable way. You're trying to give her a chance to stay in the game, but you get her jury vote once she because you're almost pulling for Rodney, but you're not pulling for Rodney because you don't want Rodney at the end anyway.
Right.
So it's kind of a win-win for you.
Total win-win for me in that situation. Plus, I get to expose the ineptness of the survival aspect of this game. Because, Riley, you want to... I respect that. I respect the survival aspect of this game. If it came down to somebody outwit, outplay, outlast, and both of them, you know, played a very similar game, I would look at to see who had the best survival skills, and that would be the way that I voted. Personally. But you never know what people are going to respect.
Right.
But I had told every single person that got voted out that I was not going to take Rodney to the end. So I thought that they would respect that more, that I stuck by my word and didn't just take the perceived goat all the way to the end, but I took stiffer competition a la Kobe. It just worked out for me this time.
Right.
It was just in the cards to work out.
Right.
Did you think Carolyn played a, not invisible, but a kind of behind-the-scenes game more than an overt game? Because your game was so overt for the last, what, six or seven outs because you're alone.
Yeah.
And you were fighting by yourself. She was more buried in her axis of evil, I guess, to some degree.
They were in a big group think. Take nothing away from Carolyn's game. But does Carolyn play her idol that night if I don't come up to her and tell her that she's going home? I don't know. Maybe she does. Maybe she sniffs it out. Mm-hmm. But I came up to her and said, you better play it for you or you better play it for C because those boys, they're coming for you. You know? And I was right.
All right, so if you don't make the final and it's Carolyn, Rodney, and Will, who are you voting for?
Carolyn.
See, I thought Carolyn played the second best game. She obviously didn't want to sit next to you, but strategy-wise, I don't know the whole social game that she played, but survivor-wise and strategy-wise, I thought she kept putting herself in the best position to stay in the game. And that's why I thought she played the second best game.
Yep. You are dead on. You are dead on. She kept actually, putting...
Joshua on our website asked this question, and I think I know the answer. Do you think Carolyn would have voted for you to leave if you had lost that final immunity?
Yep, she better.
Absolutely.
Nobody sits with me. Nobody sits with me on the end of the game. I was told that at 9.
Yeah.
I was told that when there were 9 people left in the game, nobody wants to sit with you at the end.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which I wouldn't have wanted to sit with me at the end either, honestly. I mean.
Right.
Yeah. Rodney wanted to sit with you at the end.
Yeah. He'd beat you. He knows you'd have beat you.
Well, I mean, hey, you know, he very possibly could have.
No, I think the probes pretty much showed that would not have been the case.
Well, yeah, I got something to tell you all about that off the air. So
yeah, you never.
That's
two
things now off the air.
You never know in those situations. You know, you really never know. One thing I would like to say, and this is tooting my own horn, but it's something that we're at the end of the podcast. Probably nobody's listening anyways at this point. I wrote this down. Why is being a challenge threat a bad way to win Survivor? A perceived challenge threat and winning, man, that's a really, really hard thing to do. Because look at my body type. Look at casting. Let's go from a casting point only. I'm coming into the game, I'm cast as a physical player. So right around the merge, I'm going to have a very hard time to make it to the end.
Mm-hmm.
So, was my strategy going into this game to win all the way? No, it wasn't. My strategy was to build a good alliance and stick with them and go all the way to the end. And, you know, the best man wins at the end. But I wasn't put in that situation. I was put in a situation where I had to fight for my life every single day. And it's just very interesting to me that people... They want to look at, oh, you just won challenges to win the game. Okay, that's fine if that's how you want to see it. But let's talk about the stigmata or the perception of a challenge threat actually winning the game.
Right.
It doesn't happen, and the reason it doesn't happen, Kimmy, first season, goes out and wins 4. You know, goes to the end. You know, right then you're perceived as the challenge threat can't make it to the end, can't make it to the end. Well, I have a lot of respect for challenge threat people that make it to the end because, dude, you were not supposed to be there, and you made it.
Absolutely.
Sorry, I'll toot my own horn just for a second.
No, I like it because I break the game down into 3 kind of sections. 1 is numbers, 2 is a social game, and 3 is challenges. And to me, the challenges are a small part of the game that can have a large effect, but in the end, they're a small part. If you've got numbers and if you've got a good social game. Sandra didn't win a challenge, but she had enough of a social game where she never stood out as a threat. She never stood out as somebody that needed to get voted out, and she won the game off that. And she had numbers.
Twice.
In the same degree. Twice. Yes.
Twice, dude. Hey, let's just calm everybody's greatest survivor to ever play the game, Sandra, in my opinion.
Totally agree.
Not my favorite winner. Greatest player to ever play the game of Survivor, Sandra.
Twice.
Agreed.
Sorry, twice. Say.
Much See, respect.
I don't remember which recap it was. You probably do because I'm sure you were watching. But I was telling Dwayne that once you are ostracized and playing that solo game with your new friends, Shireen and Jen, who were leaving, I was telling Dwayne, I said, you know what? His game is almost easier. If he can't get Dan and Sierra back, he's not going to get anybody back. His goal is to win that challenge for that 30, 40 minutes a day, and then he goes and sits back and just throws matches on the fire.
And he's got to do together.
Exactly.
Tyson Apostle style, man. You know, like, I love Tyson's game so much. Him just creating all the little chaos, the little moments of chaos. Oh, he's so great. Such a great winner. Such an underrated winner, in my opinion, Tyson.
And after you win 1 or 2, it's almost like you've got them mentally beaten. That if it's not an endurance thing, if we're not hanging on a rope again, I'm going to win this challenge. And you're so pumped and you're so ready. And then It's for that hour, you've got 150,000% into the game. Then you go back and you can sit in the king chair. You know, you can. Anybody want to go walk with me to get fire?
Okay. Yeah.
You know, it's to me, it's not easier, but it's almost easier because you don't have to strategize as much. All you're doing is helping guide your final two tribe mates to the end with you.
Here's the thing, though. Like, yeah, you're right. I could have won and sat back on my laurels, but I didn't. I scrambled more when I was safe than I scrambled when I was not safe.
Yeah, well, that's what I was saying, where you played like Tony, where you still kept playing. You could have sat back and done nothing, but it allowed you to focus more. Once you had the necklace, you could focus more on getting your two mates to the end with you and causing the rest of them problems.
Oh, I would take that knife, and I would jab it in there real good and deep in that ribcage area when I won the immunity necklace and be like, hey, one of y'all is going home, yay, and who's it going to be? Because I'm sitting right here ready to talk to y'all. Who wants to hear what I have to say? You know, and like that night when I played my idol and we came back in the edit, I was like, four votes, y'all. Thanks. You know what I mean? It's just like, and I kept reiterating always, y'all are not going to beat me. I'm gonna win these challenges the rest of the way out, and I really do feel like mentally I beat them. And they were like, he's unbeatable. We can't beat him. All right, now what do we do? And you do that enough times, and I said this the next to last episode, playing to the jury. Another tip for you future survivors is every time that there's a jury member present, your argument in tribal council should be to that jury member of why everyone else around you sucks.
Yep.
You know, I mean, take those opportunities, those times. And so in that tribal, I go, if you outwit, if you outplay, if you outlast long enough, then you're sitting in the final three, which is an actual backhanded compliment to my own game to the jury.
Right. You know? I think it was so bad that while y'all were at the challenges that you were about to win, they weren't even focused on the challenge. They were focused on how not to get voted out that night. You know, that's how much I think you got in their heads. They couldn't get them tongs together. They couldn't get the balance together. They're just thinking, how am I not going to get voted out? He's going to.
No, but they all worked really well together at the Maze Challenge, bunch of jerks.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get to that finale.
Yeah, let's do it.
I personally hate immunity challenge advantages this late in the game. Because I really thought that advantage for you, somebody who's already good at challenges, and so good that you're unfortunately with some that are not as good at challenges.
He earned it.
I'm not saying he didn't earn it. I'm just saying that late in the game, you know, I just don't find it as a competitive fairness, so to speak.
But that's when it's most useful. That's why it's such an awesome reward.
I agree with you completely, David. It is too much of an advantage, too late in the game, but I agree with Dwayne on the simple fact that, yo, they put that challenge out there for anyone to win. I just happened to win it.
On that side, I disagree with where it was in the game, but on the side that it was there, here's what I'd rather have seen.
Okay.
I would rather have seen your mom go out to the maze, study it, and come back and report it to you.
That is a much, much fairer way to do that challenge.
I like when we put things on family members. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let them be a part of the game. I mean, she did her best. She walked you through it. I mean, it was so bad. You were standing at the idol saying, has anybody else found a medallion before I grab the necklace? My fair for editing. Editing's like, hold on, Mike. Give us another 30 minutes. Let him find the second one. You know, it was almost that bad. I just thought it would have been neat that if she'd have gone out there and she had no paper pen, and just looked at it and studied it 30 minutes, and then she walks out and tells you everything she sees, instead of you physically walking out, putting your hands on things, getting to feel that there were actually double boards around the medallions instead of just single boards. And it almost bored the challenge. It's a great-looking challenge, one of the best-looking challenges.
Oh, my gosh. We flew over that. We flew over it in the helicopter.
Before you saw it? Before you did it?
Well, we obviously couldn't see details, but yeah, we flew over and got the aerial view of that challenge.
Yeah.
Me, Will, and Carolyn. And from the air, you guys saw it from the air in the editing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
From the air, John Q Kierhofer is one of my favorite people in the whole world that's not sucking kneecaps, that's not sucking up. The dude is a creative genius. John, if you ever listen to this, I love you, I love you, I love you. Seriously. Amazing, amazing. I agree, though. I don't agree with your point of getting the family members involved in challenges. They didn't sign up for this game. We did. So the onus should be upon us. There is a different way to do that challenge, I'm sure.
Well, that wouldn't have made her participate in it, but it would have made her a part of it.
Yeah. Well, I'll say this one thing about my mom's visit, with the challenge or whatever. Where I get, you know, where I love people and care about people, you know, comes from my mom. She came out there and she knew the story of everybody turning on me and going for me. But yet she still took the time, each person, to pull them aside, love on them, tell them stories that their families had said at dinner and stuff, and, you know, related to everybody back home's fine and good. And then she prayed for each and every single one of them. Wow. Hugged their neck and, you know, sent them on their way, just like I did.
So that is really cool. Was she just there for the afternoon? Time with,
sorry.
Go ahead. Go ahead, David.
How long was she there? Just for the day? She wasn't there overnight or anything, was she?
No, she was there all night. My mom slept on the dambu, which was the bamboo. We call it the dambu. She slept in the king's chair, and then we slept down on the beach for about 2 hours in the middle of the night. Yeah, so rough to have your mom out on Survivor, but she's a champ, dude. Did you see?
Yeah.
Hey, you know what? People can say whatever they want. My mom looks so good coming out there, dude. Good job, mom, man. I'm like,
yeah.
She's gonna get married off of this, you know? Get a talk show, something really crazy.
I love that you said that she spent time with each person relaying stories from their family, because that helped them to have a little bit of that home visit too. And yeah, that says a lot about your mom.
She's a class act, that lady. Yeah. For real.
So had they given you the option to take one other castaway and a family member just on the picnic part before you got your advantage, who back then do you think you would have chosen?
That's a good question. Nobody. We would have went to that reward all by our lonesome.
So nope. You would have said, I don't want to take anybody.
I would have said right there in front of everybody, Jeff Probst, anybody listening, hey, you know what? Suck eggs, people, because you guys have been making me earn this whole time. Me and my mom are going to have a dinner for four.
Nice. See, I love that, though, because that's the time you get to say anything and everything, all honest, and you're going to get honest feedback. The only person in the world you can trust within a billion miles at that point. And, I mean, that's great because you're already on your own anyway. You got to win. So why? And you need that moment, that hour, whatever it was, of not strategizing time. But at the same time, you are, because you're going to get feedback. You know,
And that late in the game, people take the vote out extremely personal.
Mm-hmm.
So most of the time, unless you're John Cochran, you're not getting every single person's vote.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So those two people at the end of the game, Sierra and Rodney, I was pretty sure that I wasn't going to get their vote anyway. But I knew I had the four locked up. I figured Tyler would probably vote for me just because of the social aspect. I mean, just because of the challenges and Mama C turning on him so late in the game. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, really just those last two votes, I just had to be there. I just had to make it through them because I really felt like I'd won the game if I could just make it through those last two votes.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up, you know, skating by the skin of my teeth.
Yeah, well, it was impressive to watch and fun to watch. You know, we were having podcasts and we just started saying, you know, he can actually win this thing, but he's going to have to win it out in order to do it. And you did it. It was great. It was fun.
And Dwayne finished every comment with, but I really don't want to listen to David being right.
So. At the end of all of it, watching these podcasts, reading what the writers have written, it was always fun to just be like, oh, guys, just hang on. Like, next episode's going to be so good. Yes. Just wait, you know. And having that experience and that excitement and traveling all over the country, watching these episodes with past survivors and people that are on our cast. And
right.
So much fun. Living this experience, the I feel like the Dirty 30 as a whole, we did it the right way. Yeah. We did it the way that I hope future casts see that you can play this game. You can go out there and play a cutthroat game, but be adults about it and walk away with strong relationships. Because you go through, I would never equate this to war, and thank you, men and women of our country that defend us every single day. But it's almost like that kind of bond when you come out of it. Because it's all you have is you guys, what you did on the show, right. And then you have the whole world to rip you guys apart. And the great thing about the Dirty 30 and all of us is that we've kept these relationships strong. And we're going to continue to keep them strong much further after this game's all said and done and over with.
So why was Dan targeted when he was? Was it because of his advantage or just anything else?
Well, I targeted Dan because of his stubbornness and his unwillingness to work with me again. Mm-hmm. After time and time and time again of going back to him and saying, hey, man, let's mend these relationships. The conversation at the very end, whenever Dan goes home, we started that conversation off badly together, and so it just escalated from there. But, you know, it was like a breakup that was going over the two-week period, and you saw the person every single day, and it was time for him to go. His advantage played a big part. I knew that he was coming for Carolyn or Sierra. Mm-hmm. I figured Carolyn had an idol. I didn't know, but I thought she did because she was the only one left that could possibly have it.
Yeah.
It was just the right time to get Dan. I wasn't going to vote Carolyn. I wasn't going to vote Will because I was going to take Will. I knew he couldn't win the game. So, in that moment, it was one of the blue collars that was going to go because they had turned their backs on me, and I'd worked something out with Sierra, so it just made sense to go with Dan, unknowingly that Sierra was not on board with my plan whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Sierra's the only person in this whole game that blindsided me.
Nice.
Yeah.
So, you know, good credit to her. I had a read on every single person in this game except for her, and she got me. There's a funny story about Sierra. We're laying in the not about Sierra, it's about me, but it affected Sierra. We're laying in the shelter one night, late in the game. Don't remember what day it is. But we're all in the shelter, and I'm sleeping, and I just feel this. Like somebody touched the top of my head and just went like that. And, like, I wake up in the middle of the night, like, who's touching my head? You know what I mean? And Sierra gets up. She's like, oh, my God, what's going on? What's going on? I look at the night camera guy, whose name was Zach, and I go, Zach, did you touch my head? And he's like, no, man. I'm like, somebody just touched my head. And literally, I had dreamt that somebody had come up and touched my head, and nobody did. It was so real in that moment. And we're, like, all looking under the shelter for, like, you know, somebody standing there with a machete or something. You cut us up into little pieces. Oh, gosh, that was so funny. But
production saying, oh, day 37 paranoia, here we go.
Yeah, exactly. It's just one of those things that you'll never forget in the game. That happens, you know, behind the scenes stuff that no one would ever know because it never made the edit. But right. Just fun little stories like that, stuff I'll remember the rest of my life.
Was there any stories or things you wanted to say about any of the players that you haven't gotten to say yet tonight?
There's a funny Rodney in the very beginning of the game had these dog tags that it had his grandmother and his grandfather on it, who have since passed away, I believe. And one day we were in the water and we're all jumping around doing, you know, the stupid fun things in the water. The poor kid lost these dog tags out on Survivor, you know. So I think he can get them remade. But, no, I mean, I really respected Rodney's game after it was all said and done. Didn't respect it while it was happening. I love all of these people. Each one of them brought a completely different aspect to this game, a completely honest aspect to this game. And I would like to, one thing that I felt like was a big part of my game is what I like to call the one-time shine alliance. And, you know, I really got that from Rob and Eliza back in the day, watching them play. And it's utilizing people that are not in your alliance for one vote to get out a common enemy. Mm-hmm. And it's such an under-strategized, underutilized tool to this game that Tony masterfully, oh my gosh, that guy never won a challenge or an immunity challenge either. Still, hands down, won that game.
Yeah, it was
great. So great to watch him play. Oh my, I cannot wait to play against Tony, with you, Tony, whatever. I have been in awe of that dude's game. It's so much fun to watch. But yeah, you know, I got a text message just a minute ago from the girl. She's like, this podcast is way too long. I'm getting in the bath.
It is long. We're at 2:45.
And we're almost there. So I think you said Sierra was a challenge threat elimination, yes. And more so than anything, because you wanted to take her, but at the same time, she was in your way of winning the last immunity challenge that you had to get through.
And she also betrayed me on the vote right before she went home. Yeah. That was the nail in her coffin, because I was really going to go Rodney that night.
Mm-hmm.
But the more and more I sat there and thought about it, the more it made more sense to get rid of Sierra, because she was close in the challenges. And also because I thought that if I got rid of her then, she could have 2 days to get over it, and maybe the people that are in the jury that are on my side would convince her to, you know, go ahead and vote for me, which
right.
If she would have, statistically, your boy goes down as the greatest statistically to play the game, but she didn't. So, Tom Westman, good job, buddy.
Yeah.
Were you worried at all if Rodney won the fire making challenge that he would get more votes than you thought he would?
I really and truly making them do that fire challenge, I thought I won the game. I thought no one sitting at the end of the game was there that could challenge me.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the fun in making them make challenge. I mean, okay, our season, for as bad as everybody wants to say it was or whatever their opinion on it was, we had more vote outs saved by idols than Heroes versus Villains. I think they had like 14, and we had like 17, something like that. I don't know, maybe 16 and 13. I can't remember the exact numbers. We had the only time that someone was in trouble, played an idol, saved themselves, and won the game. In this age of idols, you know, they want to talk about how powerful they are. Mm-hmm. No one's ever, besides me, and if Carolyn would have won, besides Carolyn, ever use an idol to save yourself and win the game. You know, you had a fire-making challenge at the end. You had, you know,
Wasn't it also the throne challenge?
And the throne challenge. I mean, you have the recipe for a script of Survivor that could possibly go down as one of the greatest seasons of all time. I don't know. There was a lot of really, really good strategic play that got overshadowed. There was a lot, you know.
Yeah, Jeff Pittman brings up a lot of rules that you broke for winners.
Yeah.
A really good article. I love that. He brought up so many rules that you broke that winners aren't supposed to do, and you broke three or four of them to get to the end, and that was awesome.
Yeah. Well, you know, that goes back to my Twitter handle. You can't do that, but I can. So shameless plug. Shameless plug.
There you go. So what did we miss with the jury speeches? Unless you got something before that, Dwayne, from you three. What did we miss from those? Were they just pretty redundant from what we were going to hear from the questions, or was there anything interesting?
Haley had a really good question about being in an elevator with a talent agent, producer, something like that, and you have to throw your script of your game in front of them. I didn't understand what she was saying because I was an idiot, probably still am. But Jeff had to tell me, you know, repurpose me and tell me what she was asking for, and ultimately I gave this long Lone Ranger story, and you know that was bad. I thought. I mean, it was pretty good representation, you know. I mean, everybody had a good question for everybody. The thing with me and Dan, he asked a way better question than they showed about, you know, pick things from other people's games of why, you know, they deserve to win and you don't. That type of line of questioning, which is way, way better how he said it than I could ever say it. But, you know, I knew going in to that final tribal that if I sat there and I threw the five immunities, playing my idol, you know, my relationship with everyone, that they wouldn't be received well. Mm-hmm. So going in, I knew that I needed to be humble. I knew that I needed to, you know, almost like Cocker did, like, yo, the gloves are off, ask me whatever you want, I'm not going to lie to you, you know, I'll own my game. And ultimately, I think that, you know, 6 out of the 8 people respected that, respected my game. And for somebody who had no social game whatsoever in this game of Survivor, pulling 6 of the 8 votes is a pretty good indication of, you know, that dadgummit, people do like me.
I wouldn't say you had no social game. Is that what you just said? You had no social game?
Well that's what a few writers and other people have said. I wouldn't say that I didn't have a social game, but other people have said it.
Okay.
Wow. Well, you started off the jury with your friends, so I thought that was pretty. Yeah. And two of them you sat there with smiles on their faces.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's the one last thing. I don't know if we're at that point. I think we're. Questions or something like that, but I would like to say
God played a huge part in my win in the game of Survivor. And if you subscribe to that thinking or not, you can choose to or not choose to, but I know what it meant to me to have, you know, my faith in him. Just the strength that I drew every day from my quiet time and my prayer time being with him, you know, gave me a supernatural strength that a lot of people don't know how to tap into, which is really easy. All you have to do is say a prayer. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's something that's near and dear to my heart always. And without God, there's no way I would have, you know, even number one, had the chance to go on Survivor, number two, win.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, good. All right, man. So, David, can we do kind of lightning round of questions?
We'll keep them short. I'll keep short answers.
All right.
What, you want to do from them or just last ones of ours?
I don't have any more, David. So, if you have
I just got a couple second chance questions.
Ooh.
Like, how far do you see Shireen getting?
Winner. It's my winner pick for 30.
Really?
Yeah.
Nice.
What about Joe?
It's not just because we're friends. It's because I would really like to see her play from a position of power.
Mm-hmm.
I think she's learned a lot, and I think that she can make the right alliances with the right people at the right time.
And she's Joe, max free.
And she's max free.
there you go, yes.
Joe's going to be in the exact same position he was going into our season, unless he can somehow play the protector card, have an alliance of people that are weaker in challenges than him, and they know that they're weaker, but yet that he's going to go out and be the winner for that group of people, to protect his group, which may allow him to get further enough in the game to where he can go on an immunity run as well. The thing that he's going to be in big trouble with is he's coming off of a season where he won 2 immunity challenges. You just saw the winner win 5. So the threat of the physical challenge is going to be ever-present in this season. And you have a winner – I mean, not a winner. You have a guy on your season as well that has won 5 already. So, yeah. I mean – there's going to be the guys are going to be in trouble if the girls can even sniff it out. Because if the girls are smart, they get the numbers and they keep the numbers the rest of the game, and you're sitting with 5 women in the end.
I agree that we could be looking at a female winner because these guys are so challenge strong. This is such a strong group of challenge guys. They're just going to – who are they going to look at other than each other?
Yeah.
And they're going to agree with the women to vote out this other challenge threat, this other challenge threat, so they get a better chance of winning challenges. I mean, it's just really set up that we could have a female winner.
I hope we have a female winner. I mean, unless it's Joe. You know, unless Joe wins, I hope we have a female winner this season because, man, there are so many strong girls that have played this game, and there's so many strong girls on this cast that are coming up. I'm excited to watch. I really, really am.
Yeah. Go ahead,
all right.
David.
That was it. Go ahead, Dwayne.
All right. So I've been asked a lot of questions, most of which you've already answered, but this one was the one that he said interests him the most. I hope you guys get to the bottom of it, he says. Why was Haley the one targeted over Jen or Shireen when Joe won immunity? Was it because they were wary of Jen after the idol play?
The groundwork was already laid to get Haley out when we switched it to Jen the first time. And then whenever Joe won again, everybody was just like, look, we went for Jen last time. We didn't get her. She's kind of when Joe won and she realized the position she was in, we all realized that she realized where she was at. There was no reason at that point to get rid of Jen because we felt like she was probably either going to quit or just kind of stop playing the game altogether anyway. So Haley, in that particular vote, it was already set up for her to go home. We had already talked about Haley going home. It was just an easy vote. And we didn't think that Jen was going to continue to play as hard as she was in the first part of the game.
All right. Rachel asks, if Tyler hadn't told Will that Mike, Jen, and Shireen were accusing him of hoarding food, could the big argument have been avoided?
I don't think that we would have let... No, it would have happened. Because we had told enough people at that time what we were doing, and we were trying to, or I was trying to stir up trouble. Didn't expect it to go as far as it did, but no, it would have come out. It would have come out.
Right.
Anyway.
Okay.
It was almost a backhanded strategic compliment that they were accusing him of cooking food.
That's your boy Tyler calling right now. I wonder if he's listening. Should we pick it up? Should we answer Tyler's phone call?
Sure, answer it and put him on.
Tyler, hold on. Let's see. Tyler.
Hey, bud.
Dude, you're on with D&D.
Hey, Tyler.
Can y'all hear me?
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, say hello to D&D real quick.
D&D my boys, what's going on?
Is it D&D my boys, what's going on? They said hello.
Said hello.
Okay, I'll call you back, Ty.
They can't hear a thing.
No, I know. I'll call you back.
Yeah, we can hear him, but he can't hear us because you got earphones in.
All right, so we're going to honor the fact that we told people they could do hashtag STWD.
No, dude, I want to hear the questions from the people.
Yeah, all right, so here we go. This is from Heather Marie. Hi, Mike. I'm a huge fan. My question is, would you change anything you did in the game? If so, what would it be?
I think we go into like a butterfly effect here, and if we did change something, it changes the outcome of the end of the game. The only thing I think I would have changed, is we talked about it, was not giving my word to Dan and still doing the play, but not giving my word and going back on it.
All right. This is from Friends for Life. What are you allowed to bring with you from home when being on Survivor?
The pre-approved clothes that they give you and the shirt on your back whenever you walk out there. I brought a huge Texas flag like Colby did for my luxury item, but we were never afforded those luxury items.
Oh, wow. Okay. And here's just a compliment, Massive Fish. If you were asked to come back, please do. You were a great player and made the season more enjoyable.
Oh, thanks, Massive Fish. I appreciate it.
Yep, that question's already been asked. Here's one. This is from Annie Armiger. What did you feel was your biggest strategical move in Survivor Worlds Apart?
Biggest strategical move. Maybe... Just following Joe and Tyler, getting that clue to the idol, because ultimately that's what saved me and helped me go on and win the game. That's so true. I would have to say that would be a big strategic move.
All right, I agree. Well, this is from It's Me, Candy Cane Swag. What was the hardest part about being shut out by everyone while on the island?
I just read a tweet on my Twitter. I'm not gonna. It is hashtag to you guys, but it is somebody that tweeted in about an earlier conversation that puts this big smile on my face. What was the question? Sorry,
I've already cleared it off.
The hardest part about being alone.
Yeah. What was the hardest part about being basically ostracized?
The hardest part about that was I'm a very talkative individual. I like to talk, communicate with people, and being cut off, having that communication was the toughest part.
All right. Raylan Barber says, what challenge did you find the most challenging, LOL?
Challenging would have been probably the slide puzzle was extremely challenging because you had three different slides that you had to go through to get to the actual slide puzzle. Mm-hmm. But the hardest one was the pole challenge. I mean, that's the don't get me wrong, glad I got to do it, part of it, but that's the stupidest challenge in Survivor. We hate it so much, dude. Hate that challenge.
All right. Here's one from Shell Mom, Rochelle Mailet. Watching you on STWDD and glad that you liked her video. I don't know, so you must have liked someone's video.
Okay.
She said, yay and thanks. She's 4.5 and loved your happy dance.
I know this girl. They sent a video the other day on my Twitter, and I saw it, and I loved it. It, like, literally made my day. It's her 4-year-old daughter, and she's, doing the happy dance, and so cute. When people send me that kind of stuff, like, it literally puts a smile on my face that day that it just doesn't come off. It's awesome.
This guy wants to know, I am our happy. What are Mike's favorite Survivor seasons?
Ooh, I mean, come on, Heroes versus Villains. Everybody's one of everybody's favorites. I like season one. I love season one. I love Richard Hatch. I love the way that he, on the fly, figured out this whole alliance thing. I love that he was brash and in your face, played a game that I don't think gets as much credit as he should. What other season? If I'd have to give you one other season that I loved, I mean, season 24, I love the winner. Obviously, One World, Kim Spradlin. A fun season that I really, really enjoyed watching. I really watched Brian play the game. Mm-hmm. Brian Heidick. There was a lot of social stuff that happened in his season that kind of got overcast as well. But yeah, Brian Heidick, and I went way longer on this question than I intended to. But yeah, the Palau was really amazing as well.
Awesome. And you didn't mention Kageyan. I'm interested. I'm in surprise.
Oh yeah, how could I not mention Kageyan? We've great.
The three format tribe, my favorite.
Awesome.
Favorite.
All right. This is from Josh Foster. Why was Sierra perceived as more of a challenge threat than Mama C, given she had won 2 immunities and Sierra had not won any?
Not perceived. It's actuality. Mama C was great at endurance challenges. Sierra was always on my tail. I mean, she was right there.
Yeah.
She was like a step or two behind, like I was a step or two behind Joe. You know, I was always right there on Joe, and Sierra was always right there on me.
Yeah. All right. This is from Jesse Norwalt. What was the hardest challenge you had to win after the merge?
The holding on to the 25% of your weight. Yeah. Here's the thing. That whole challenge, I prayed the whole time for the strength of Samson. Just kept praying it.
Your hair's too short.
I used to have really long hair. I'm actually thinking about growing it back out. But yeah, that was by far super tough challenge.
Yeah. LOL on the T. That's from Linda Fowler.
LOL on the T.
Yeah, I'm not sure what that is.
Is that like the Sweet Tees, my t-shirt company that me and my friends just started?
No, I doubt
no?
that. But I do want to talk.
Oh, LOL on the T.
On the t-shirt. Okay.
I got it.
All right, last one that's showing up on my stream, although I know there was one that somebody said, what do your neighbors think about you doing a code 10 outside?
I really hope that they're not paying attention because they might have some sweet photographs to sell.
That would be bad. Liara Petty, if you had to do the entire game all over with a completely different alliance, who would have been in it?
Ooh, that's easy. Max, Joe for the two boys, and the three girls would have been Haley, Shireen, and Kelly.
Awesome. Ivan has another question for you. What's next for Mike? Will the Sweet Tees design T-shirts be shipping outside of the USA? I'm buying hundreds.
Ivan, thank you for that. Absolutely. I went this weekend. That's where I was this whole weekend. We were working on the website. We were working on new designs. This website has been a nightmare. We were supposed to have it done before the finale started. But yes, SweetTeesDesignShop.com should be up and going this week. We ship out of the United States. We ship in country. We don't just only have the Texas flag. We've got other designs that are actually already there. We do vinyl. We do custom work. That's what's next for me. I'm blue collaring the Sweet Tees Design Shop, working hard every single day towards it. And I mean, we're a grassroots company, people. So, you know, give us a little bit of leadway to make business mistakes. But just like in the game of Survivor, I bounce really good back from a mistake. So if I mess up or do something wrong, you know, let me make it up.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a third thing that I want to talk to you about after we're off the air.
Sweet.
Your T-shirt stuff.
I love the little things about Survivor because it was Tyler who, like you said, gave you the clue to find Joe's idol that you ended up using to get Tyler out. But It was also Tyler that won the challenge that allowed you to get your biggest challenge thread out, Joe.
Absolutely. So, absolutely.
Tyler's still waiting for his check, so anyway.
Yeah. Tyler!
All right, Kathy Trantham, who is the queen of the Zumba land.
Hi, Kathy! I see your tweets, Kathy, just so you know.
Thank you for your honesty and boldness and your faith. Fist bump to my Christian bro. It's from Kathy.
Give it to your girl. Yeah, she told me to actually ask you guys about her. So.
Yeah, I don't doubt it. Who? Kathy who? Something about a water cooler.
Who's Kathy?
Yeah.
On first.
Yeah. Hey, somebody wants to know, I think Allison wants to know, what church do you go to in Texas?
Right now I go to Gateway. I've been at my church at New Beginnings International Church for 18 years. My best friend is leaving to start his own ministry called Real Church. And it's just people being real, you know, like you come into church in shorts and a t-shirt and, you know, like who cares, you know, we're real people helping out other real people. But right now I've been attending Gateway. I'm not going to tell you which campus because I don't want you guys to come.
You don't want them to come?
No, I don't want them to come to find me. You know, go listen to Jesus or the pastor, but don't come to find me.
Yeah, Gateway's got a lot of great worship stuff on YouTube.
Great. One of my really good friends named Eric Orson is one of the music pastors there, and he is phenomenal, along with Amber Rhodes. Yeah. They are amazing, amazingly talented people.
All right, so did you have any prepared questions for us tonight, 3 hours and 7 minutes in? I'm not sure if this is longer than our Tony podcast yet, so we got a few more minutes to go.
Ooh, I'm going to have to go back and watch the Tony podcast. Dude, what in the world has happened to him, by the way? I would love to. Tony, if you ever watch this, call me, text me, follow me on Twitter. Let's DM, dude. Let's pregame alliances. No, I'm kidding. I don't pregame. Yeah, I would love to talk to Tony, man. He's such an interesting character. Questions for you guys. Okay,
You had them like written down or something.
Well, no, I do feel like I have a question. You guys are big fans, and don't sugarcoat this. One through 30, where does 30 land?
That's a David question.
See, I have a lot of my, I don't like to rank for the reason of I find goodness in different seasons, even in the seasons people find the worst, the most boring. Even One World, which is very lopsided, I still found it really good, intriguing in different parts. I'll be honest, this season finished a lot stronger than it ran through the middle. Some really good episodes in the middle. I love the drama of the auction episode. I love the drama of the auction. I love the three-tribe format. And I love how it ended because you went on a full arc. I even wrote it down. I wrote down your arc of Part one was, I'm ready, I'll do it, we are family. You know, that was you right at the beginning. Then number two was, Mike the workaholic, and everybody else should be too. Then number three was, Mike the alliance builder, hold the collar. You know, Russell Crowe calls hold the line in Gladiator, hold the collar.
Mm-hmm. Cholera. Mm-hmm.
Cholera. And number four was number four was Mike the threat, a secret no more. And then part five was Mike on a mission alone. And I love the story arc of that season. And to me, if you hadn't won, I'll be honest, I would have been highly disappointed. To me, the season would not have been as good. Right. And the fact that you won, and I don't care what the vote total was, I just like the fact that you got votes because of how you played. And it wasn't because they hated Will or they hated Carolyn. I felt that the majority of the votes you got, the votes you needed to win, were because of how you played, how you carried yourself, especially when you reached out to those who were also outcasts, when you were outcasted. You know, I thought the story was good. I thought Rodney putting up a fight was good. I didn't think he landed any punches, or at least too many, but I found him actually, I underestimated him by far, you know, early in the season. And just getting to the end, he was much better to watch and enjoy. I even enjoyed Carolyn. I thought she was playing a very under-edited game. I thought she was much better. And even watching Ponderosa, we learned that Tyler was playing a much better game than he was getting credit for.
Such a good game he played. Yeah. I mean, him and Rodney were the two for in that alliance, the Axis of Evil, they were the two bright spots. I mean, Rodney had this uncanny ability to make us all laugh all the time. Mm-hmm. And the guy could say the most outrageous thing, and it'd be funny and enduring, you know. So, yeah, I mean, it's such a fun, oh my gosh, such a fun experience.
Yeah.
I get so excited and giddy just thinking about, even if I wouldn't have won, just to play the game of Survivor, to be one of those 460 people that I've dreamt about for 15 years. I mean, it's so humbling, so awesome that you have a dream, and not only do you get to live it, but it's like the best dream. You know what I mean? It's like, like you couldn't have dreamt a better scenario, because, I mean, this was – I'll say it once, and I'll say it again and again and again. I prayed for such a hard season because I wanted to come out of the end of it going – yo, I went up against the best,
right?
And I ended up winning, which, you know, thank God that's how it went. And
yeah. Well, that's what I liked about your story arc, is that you went through the different phases of the winners. You had the numbers, you lost the numbers, you won the challenges, you lost one challenge, but you fought, got the idol, and just the way to play. You didn't sit back through the last third of the game with your minions and knock off people.
Yeah.
You sat back alone. And then just
fight and claw for it.
Exactly. You fought towards the end, and that. I don't know. I would say I don't keep track of all the seasons to the point where I rank them, but definitely one of my more favorite seasons. I'll admit that. I won't say it was number one. I have like five number ones, so I don't know. But I would say one of my more favorite seasons. And I'll admit that getting to talk to some of the survivors this season and getting a few comments during the season just made it that much better.
Oh, yeah.
You know? I mean, talking to Scoopin' after Philippines made Philippines even better than it was.
Right.
You know, talking to Tony afterwards made Cagayan even better than it was. And talking to Cass, and even Kelly Wentworth, and we got to talk to her so much.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I'm not saying San Juan del Sur got better, but anyway, but talking to...
San Juan Soldier was good, dude. It was a tough season for me to watch because they were on my beach, and I'm like, that's my lake, get out of my lake. But, you know...
But I'm like Steve Helling. Any survivor is good survivor.
It's good survivor.
I just love Survivor. Me and Dwayne are the same in that. We just
Dan
love
made a comment like that early in the game. Dan and you were on the beach, and Dan was like, we're on Survivor.
Yeah, the worst day of Survivor is still better, you know,
that's
than
right.
so many other
it's
days.
It's true. I mean, and I've been there for the worst days, and it really is so much better than other days. I would like to bring up Natalie Anderson, though, too, real quick before we jump off here. Hey, you know, such a deserving winner of the Game of Survivor. When I first started watching, I was like, an amazing racer. You know, but, man, she woke up at the right time during that game and really down the stretch won it. You know, like no one else couldn't take that from her. She won it. So, wow, I'm getting
I felt like she was in a position to jog through most of the game, but when she had to, she sprinted.
Yeah.
And she waited for the right moment. I know she's an amazing racer too. I never felt that way when she once the game got going. Never felt that was being brought up or anything. It did make it for a good finish for that.
Yeah.
She did really, really, really good. I felt.
Is Natalie calling you now too?
No, that was. I'm not gonna say.
All right.
I'm getting yelled at for being on this podcast too long. No, she would never yell.
You're not married yet.
I would like to be.
Well, I hope it hasn't felt too long for you, because we've really enjoyed the 3 hours and 15 minutes hanging with you.
I loved it.
And,
I love it.
And we still got off-the-air comments to share. So
yeah, we still got a couple things to talk about.
So. Hey, I tell you guys like this. I love the game of Survivor. I love talking strategy. I love talking little nuances of the game because it can only make me a sharper player. Right. And so if I ever do get a chance to go back on and play again, I've got a few tricks up my sleeve that I have yet to share.
Yeah.
And, we'll see what happens.
Well, thank you so much for being on the show. We do want to remind everybody that we don't have sponsors, so we really do appreciate our D&D patrons as well as all of you who shop Amazon. stwdd.com/Amazon, or for our Canadian friends, Amazon CA.
STWDD. Take off, eh, you hoser?
Take off, eh? Check out our Facebook group. Check out our Facebook group, stwdd.com/Facebook. Follow us on Twitter, @Survivor_Talk. I think we are approaching 1,500 followers.
Whoa.
Pretty amazing. Check out our other podcast, Movie Talk with D&D. We have two recent movies, Die Hard and Super 8. And we're about to do the Double Date Edition, where our wives pick a movie, and me and David sit with our wives and talk about them.
So crushing that,
not the wives, but the movie. All right. So thanks again for listening, everybody. David and I are going to hang around after the show and talk to Mike about a few things, and wish we could share it with you, but we can't. So see you, everybody.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye, everybody.